After 3 years, we finally get to the end of Ruby Season 1. Finally, a definitive season finale by which to judge the effectiveness of the build-ups and payoffs. Because in the first two volumes, so after hitting the screenwriting equivalent of rock bottom, there are two paths you can go. You can bounce, or you can crash through the ceiling of hell like a rotationally challenged Kool-Aid man. So did Ruby take the RVB 13 route? Or did making something worse than Ruby Volume 2 require more effort than they were physically capable of exerting? See, Volume 2 didn't really give them any recourse to recover the fumbled story. Or does the word fumble imply that something was being handled in the first place? Probably. I mean, an analysis of an unfinished work should get less and less relevant as more information gets released, but my Volume 1 review is still just as relevant, if not more, than it was when I made it. Mainly because lack of any kind of plot at all continued to be the main problem with Ruby. Therefore, Volume 3 can be looked at in two disparate ways. One, as if the first two volumes never happened. So you sit there like, oh, okay. And you wonder if they legitimately got Vic Mignogna liquored up before showing him the script. Or two, as if the first two volumes did happen, and you sit there in a moral quandary questioning whether a retcon can be considered good writing if the things that were retconned were worse than the things that they were retconned to, while simultaneously questioning whether any of the retcons were actually intentional.
I'm not good at a lot of memory-related things. It's really, really bad.
Because if we already acknowledge the first two volumes of Ruby, that comes with the understanding that the writer's relationship with continuity is only slightly less amicable than that of Oberyn Martell in The Mountain. I mean, the opening scene of this volume is supposed to serve as some sort of recap for the non-story up to this point, and it serves its purpose.
Haven't gotten kicked out of Beacon yet, so that's cool.
Ruby's on a team.
I think being on a team with Yang helps.
It took 8 episodes to establish that in Volume 1. Why couldn't we have just started the whole series here? There are some teachers.
And I met some teachers.
And there are some bad guys.
We've also stopped some bad guys too.
And I mean, that's it. That's an accurate recap.
This was one of the scenes that Monty had planned in the treatment for this season.
He wanted to do this because he wanted to have like a recap of everything that happened.
Yeah.
The self-awareness is frankly staggering. But unfortunately, the first continuity error clocks in at 1 minute and 44 seconds into the first episode. This is going to be eventful.
I still wonder why Ozpin let me into the school early.
I mean, it's because you asked to enroll. It's because you showed skill at using
one of the most dangerous weapons ever designed?
I mean, I always figured the pretense of the scene was supposed to be that she beat up all these guys. I mean, Ozpin is supposed to be the fucking Lush, not Ruby, right?
The Ozpin and Rick connection is a lot stronger than you might think.
The more I get to know him, the more he starts sounding like Uncle Crow.
Oh yeah, and I called that 2 years ago, too. No big deal. This scene is trying to be cheeky with the foreshadowing at the cost of continuity, because the interrogation scene from the pilot was framed like a fucking interview. I mean, that's what made it a good scene. You go in with the expectation that Ruby is in trouble, but then it gets turned on its head by Ozpin's actions. Ruby didn't get thrown in a van or just wake up on Beacon's lawn one day. I mean, it's a school. The headmaster let her in. Why are you trying to force some air of mystery around this? Oh, hey, look, her dad is painted onto the background. Oh, hold on. There, fixed. Who remembers my Volume 2 review, where I harped on about how I liked the lighting so much? You know, because it wasn't flat and simple like it was in Volume 1, it was just dynamic enough to enhance the scene. Well, here there's a sunset in the background, but in the wide there are light beams gleaming through these trees at this angle. All the characters have 12 o'clock shadows, and to make matters worse, we're made acutely aware of the position of the sun, because the scene starts and ends with a big ol' money shot of it. And it doesn't correlate to any of the shadows.
Some of our amazing art.
But honestly, I think the lighting is the best writer in the show, because it perfectly symbolizes everything wrong with the entire series. There's no core. There's no singular direction. The most prominent element is something we're all expected to take for granted, while every other aspect of the scene refuses to corroborate the existence of that element and even outright contradicts it.
Amazing art.
This sun can't exist, not with these shadows, not with that sunset, not with the trees lit this way. The sun, the soul, can't possibly exist. And then, as if we didn't get it yet, Monty Ohm.
Bruce Lee said at one point, you need to exercise speed, accuracy, power. Accuracy is how close you get to your vision.
That's his legacy. The bright star that cast no shadow on the insignificant specks of dirt who are lucky enough to get caught in his orbit. Nowhere is that more clear than in the first 12 seconds of the first action scene in Volume 3. Let's just watch this. Ruby swings her scythe at nothing. Maybe you could argue that talking to her mother's grave is evidence enough that she believes in ghosts, but still. What did they ever do to her? She does this spin move, slamming her scythe into the ground, then, runs off. Okay? Guys, what was that?
The idea is to utilize motion in a way where you don't waste movement.
After this twirl, the rifle end of Crescent Rose is pointed in a direction. Maybe you might think that she's about to fire in that direction, but no, she just runs off in that direction. 3 seconds in, and I'm already baffled by the incompetence of the fight choreography. And remember when I used to praise the cinematography in the series? Well, that's a thing of the past. Let's do some battlefield analysis. So the camera move starts on Ruby, and pans right to Blake, pans left and zooms in on Weiss, and then pans left again to follow Yang. Giving the benefit of the doubt, we'll assume that Ruby is actually running towards someone, exiting through the right of the frame. We see Blake and Reese fighting, a fight which Blake has clearly had enough of because she disengages and runs off, exiting through the bottom left of the camera, hopefully again running towards someone. I say hopefully because Weiss, who was doing nothing previously, attacks in that same direction, then follows Blake, completely ignoring the Jet Set Radio reject, while Yang and Arslan enters from frame right. Then she fires at this coquettish angle that is not likely pointing at anything. There's no good way to link the positions of these angles of assault. Ruby's fighting someone at range and then decides to close the distance. That's the only reasonable part of this mess. When the scene starts with Blake fighting Reese and Yang fighting Arslan, which means Weiss should be fighting the guy Ruby isn't fighting. Yang disengages Arslan and fires at where Reese was 5 seconds ago and then runs off in that direction, putting herself in between Arslan and Reese, who probably recently suffered a stroke. But she's still disengaging Arslan and putting her whole team at risk by allowing them to get flanked on all sides, which is not the kind of thinking that gets you voted into the next round of combat.
Yeah, we're gonna kick some butt!
Blake and Yang both turned their backs on their opponents. Blake drew Reese in to flank Weiss. Ruby decided running towards her opponent was a better idea than shooting him. These characters are fucking retarded. I'm glad the cinematic camera swoosh took me away from that garbage because I've seen enough of it for 2 lifetimes and it's only 12 seconds long.
I think it's safe to say this match may be one of the closest we've seen in the 4-on-4 round of the tournament.
This is the closest round they've seen? Why are they making the special classes fight? And almost immediately, I'm just as sick of these two.
If this is your first time watching, allow us to break down the rules.
Now, I can talk about dumping exposition and how the human brain works all day. This is information the audience should know. It's good to know that all 4 members don't move on every time a team wins. But 2 important questions arise. Did we have to know this right now? And is there a better way to let us know? The answer to those questions are no and yes, respectively. We inherently understand that there are 4x4 rounds because we just watched one start. That's the only relevant round right now. And it would be jarring for the next match to start only to be a 2v2 without any explanation. So there's a window of time where getting us this exposition would be advantageous. Is there a better way to deliver this information? Well, obviously. The question should be, is there a worse one? Short of Miles breaking into each of our houses and smearing the information on our walls in his own shit, I can't really think of one. To break down the reasons why this is so shit, it's inelegant, and it's happening in the middle of a fight. A fight, mind you, that just got touted as being super close.
This match may be one of the closest we've seen in the 4-on-4 round of the tournament.
And thus, cutting away from it is a really bad broadcasting decision. This tournament is held semi-annually.
We all forgot what the word annual meant.
And it's the most important fucking thing in the worldwide culture of Remnant. And it's fucking taught in schools.
In a tournament-style duel,
people should have a baseline understanding of it. And even if they don't, it's a tournament. They're here to watch children beat the fuck out of each other for the amusement of the 2D background painted masses. What the fuck? I mean, all these people are just cut out art assets pasted onto the background. That's what I do. Get in there, lobster with a pencil. This is your moment. I'm beginning to think Gray lied to me.
It was genuine style choice.
See, I believed you back then, because the fans didn't like the silhouette characters, so you changed them. You compromised your artistic vision to make the fans happy, but then why did you change this time? When do you say enough is enough? And if you really wanted to make the fans happy, why don't you write a decent fucking script? I mean, there is one line separating
one of the closest we've seen in the 4-on-4 round of the tournament
from
allow us to break down the rule.
Insult to injury, that line in the middle referenced the fact that the match was being broadcast live.
For those of you just now joining us, welcome to the final festival tournament!
What kind of writer thinks the audience for a tournament wants to see two dipwads dipwadding instead of watching the closest match in the tournament so far? I mean, nobody turns on a football game and hears set hike, and then it looks like we're gonna have another riveting play, don't you think?
If this is your first time watching football, I mean right now, if you are literally being introduced to the concept of football during this game that's already in progress, the way it's played is that the burly men line up facing each other and then proceed to fondle each other until the most homophobic player carries the ball farthest away from all the man love. After that, the team with the fewest awkward boners is awarded an arbitrary number of points. Back to you, Dave.
Well, John, that's not how the game is played at all. Who keeps letting you into the commentator's booth?
Your mother.
Damn it, Mom. And to make matters worse, later on in this very episode, they discuss a scene.
We put it to a vote.
Not show us a scene, mind you. They discuss something that happened off screen. Nonetheless, the scene they decided the audience did not need to see was of a team meeting where they decided which members would move on to the 2v2 round.
We voted for Weiss and Yang.
Why didn't you show us this scene and skip the retarded exposition dump at the top of the fight? These people are maliciously bad at writing, but thankfully for them, the animation is worse. Wait, does that make sense? Blake and Reese are back to fighting, or maybe they're playing a game of Pong, whacking the hoverboard back and forth. While I was watching this, I couldn't help but think, catch it. If you catch it and hold it, she won't have a weapon. Don't return it directly to her. I might as well point out something I appreciate. This is a pretty cool, well-animated combo where Blake is using her powers to push forward into her defense. It's a super creative combo, unique to Blake's power, even though it backfires on her because Reese knows how to parry. It's the kind of thing that makes you go, yeah, that's actually kinda cool. Until you wonder how the cut-in-half hoverboard realized that it was supposed to turn into guns. Like, she didn't push any buttons or anything. And now we get to another reoccurring problem in Ruby. And that's the way the writing chains together stupid things to distract us from how bad it's really getting. In this volume, Miles and Carrie have some degree of control over the fight scenes.
You know, we were writing out like lots of detailed moves and the progression of the fight and
well, that really helped the team though.
You know, so you guys actually started to not only deliver the in and out points of the fight, but you kind of deliver the beats of what moments you wanted in it. The animators would run with that, and our camera team would just, you know, make those shots look even sexier, and just everybody was firing all cylinders. It was great.
Yeah, it was cool because it's still been a very clever process. We can talk about this more into the other fights, but just because we boarded a fight didn't mean that it would stick there. That was the groundwork.
These reaction shots. Oh, dear God, the reaction shots. Every single tournament fight, except one, is littered with these stupid, awful, insulting, cancerous reaction shots where characters just stand stock still, posing for the camera, politely waiting for their turn to attack. Sometimes, they last over a second. Even gravity itself kowtows to the reaction cutaway.
The audience don't know the rhythm's there until it's not there.
I know you have to be pretty dense to think that reaction cutaways are a good idea, but nothing has the inertia to get 3 seconds worth of hang time like that.
It was amazing to see Team Ruby in such fine form again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The amount of time characters spend not moving at all is simply staggering. Like this guy, appropriately named Nadir, which means lowest point. Now, after watching this series more times than my doctor recommended, I can safely say that this is the worst fight in the series. So Ruby Volume 3 gains one more coincidental self-awareness point. The fuck were we talking about? These lines in the floor may look like changes in elevation, but they're actually cosmetic. I mean, this character has a hard enough time putting her feet on the floor. We don't need to worry about the floor being one of those 3D perspective chalk drawings now, do we? We end up with another case of people doing nothing whatsoever. So, Yang is fighting this one, and this guy is facing this direction for no reason whatsoever. A- anyway, he gets shot in the shoulder from behind, and in the next frame, his feet are the thing that got frozen. Whoever animated this must not have watched enough Bill Nye as a kid, because a cold doesn't sink that fast, but I digress. Look at this guy. He's immobilized. Yang's angry. She's ready to go. This guy's in trouble. And then we cut away from the impending brutality, because this is a family show after all. Why is Ruby lying down? So three members of team... something are accounted for. Where's the fourth guy? He must have been fighting with Weiss. Now, if he used to be fighting Weiss, he would have seen this coming.
Got your back!
Who's got yours?
This asshole has a clear shot at his opponent's back while she's lying down on the job, and he starts talking, only serving to alert her to his presence and give Weiss, who, if object permanence is still a thing, he was fighting not more than a couple seconds ago, with a chance to kick him through a thing. So what was happening before the camera was on them? How did he forget he was fighting Weiss? Or how were they not fighting with the other three members of each team accounted for? What, was he jacking off behind the rocks? Oh, he landed in his own jizz. So, we're supposedly still assuming that Blake and Reese are making bedroom eyes at each other. Yang is presumably turning Nadir into a fine red mist. Okay, I have a question. His feet aren't on the ground? That's not a question. Okay, hold on. How was this scythe swing supposed to do damage to him? Like, she missed. By a lot. Does she know how scythes work? Does anyone? Especially the people who animate these fights? Cause scythes aren't really efficient one-on-one fighting tools. They require insane lateral agility. So someone like Ruby, who can run past her opponent holding a scythe at her side, could do some serious damage with it. Or someone like Weiss, who could throw up glyphs and zip around her opponent wildly. If she was using a scythe instead of a rapier, this train car would have opened a lot like this. But using it in a straight-up fight is really ineffective, as evidenced by this. So you have a very small window to actually do damage to them unless you hit them with the sharp tip or move past them laterally, which is what makes Crow's weapon so stupid. There will never be an instance where a scythe is more advantageous than a greatsword. Even in the scene where he uses it in scythe form. Fuck, especially in that scene where he uses it in scythe form. Like, this is bullshit. His scythe has a blade on the outside, which, I mean, is better than a regular scythe, but the blade gets shorter over the arc of the swing, whereas a greatsword gets longer. Ruby's semblance makes her scythe a viable option, but Aura immediately counters its only use. The most dangerous weapon ever designed, my ass. Dangerous to grass, maybe. What, does everybody stay away from the hunters with scythes because they know they're dumb, so they need to get gardening work on the side?
It's more like a more traditional farm, reaping scythe.
If he hadn't blocked that, Ruby would have missed, and she wouldn't have been in a position to shoot him in the face. I mean, he knew that her scythe was a gun. He watched her fire it at his teammate mere seconds ago. Whatever. Ruby and Weiss stand there and watch Bolin for soup run past them, and they don't follow. Hey, Reese. You standing there? That's cool. Where's Blake? Oh, there she is. Just standing there too, I see. Yeah, no, that's cool. How's this guy doing? Yang didn't do anything to him. She just stood there, staring at her immobilized opponent like a deer in the headlights, but like a stupid deer. She had almost a minute. Oh, I don't even care. Have I given up already? It's like 6 minutes into the first episode. They premiered this at RTX, you know.
Yeah. You guys actually premiered this to an audience, right?
Yeah,
what was the response to that?
They probably cheered. A lot of bureaucratic woes Shane and Dylan went through to animate this scene came through in a letter Shane wrote, and I feel for their situation. But he actually referred to Dylan's work as top-notch, which is just... how? When they say put your best foot forward, I think they mean relative to the camera, not relative to the direction the character is facing. You don't frame your worst foot front and center.
Then how do we make that not look so floaty?
Yeah, really, the ground isn't a suggestion. Look at this asshole. He's not only stationary, he's in the default pose. You got the floating ball, default pose man, hover shoes. Time itself was abused by this shot. Look how close the ball gets to her. And now look how far away it is 2 seconds later. Watch it fail to close this distance for 5 seconds. We all saw that great Every Frame of Painting video.
Show it twice, and the audience's mind will make it one hit that's stronger.
But that doesn't count if all the editing continuity on the preceding shots are bollocks. But they stand in a single column, perfectly aligned for Yang to get a triple kill. What about the fourth one? Yeah, the girl who lost 27% of her aura with one hit.
We keep talking about how aura is basically a health bar. It's a health bar. Yeah.
Do I even have to bring this up?
You have a lot of it.
I do, actually. See, if Jean can have a lot of aura, that means there's not a consistent amount. I don't know if you know how percentages work, but they're relative. Hypothetically, if someone has, like, 1,000 aura, and they go up against a team with 100 aura each, he could be eliminated with more health than any of them have at their total.
Because obviously we need them to move on for plot reasons and
gotcha,
stuff. And
yeah.
We're like, we gotta make sure that they're
so you just had
it.
Us win for plot reasons. Thanks.
Never mind. Aura's bullshit. No one cares. Just the sheer volume of awfulness in this fight could make you miss that they won because of teamwork and physics and a tandem attack to be proud of. If it was used in a less stupid way, it would have been a seriously heavy-hitting moment. But as a capstone of a fight like this, it's just... If they had used that attack to, like, knock out Arslan while she was winding up to break this floating snowball, causing the other two to roll out of the ring, it would have been great! You would have been able to bypass the time buggery in the editing of the shot. See, problem solved. Speaking of time buggery, why did Ruby jump the second time? I mean, like, yeah, I know, it's a cute little mashing scene transition, but really, think about it. She jumped a second time after taking a shuttle down from the floating Colosseum, having a discussion about who would move on to the doubles round, and making their way all the way to the fairgrounds. But in the grand scheme of things, I did only include this point so the commenters accusing me of nitpicking could be right about something. If I'm being totally honest, I actually thought the talking bits here were more enjoyable than the action bits in this volume, primarily because of how the intentional and unintentional elements play off of each other to enhance the viewing experience. Truly, making Ruby Volume 3 a gesamtkunstwerk of awful. Can we at least pretend to be professional here? Or better. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about.
If only there were somewhere on campus to get food around here.
The intentional element of this scene is that Ruby fails to understand sarcasm.
It's okay, Weiss. I forget about the fairgrounds too.
Or the word facetious.
I was being facetious. Well, if you were hungry, why didn't you say so?
Which is a dumb joke, but the unintentional aspect of this scene is that none of the characters react to it, and Yang immediately changes the subject.
Come on. I know just the place.
Which elevates the joke to actually mimic real characterization. Doesn't this scene play off as if Ruby not knowing the difference between famished and facetious is a common occurrence, and Yang is trying to change the subject to save her sister a little embarrassment? And Blake standing there for 11 seconds, unmoving. I guess you could say she's in a catatonic state.
You did it. Good job. I can't believe it. I'm proud of you.
She's probably just trying to figure out if she can still act on this suggestive wink, even though she's basically single-handedly eliminated her from the tournament. Ship Chlorofeline is sinking, isn't it? You know, I might not have even noticed Blake not moving if there hadn't been more movement going on in the background than the foreground. And if I wasn't focused on the background, I probably wouldn't have noticed the spectacular jump cut, where everyone teleports like 10 yards forward in the space of one frame. There's just a brilliant creative dichotomy here. Instead of fixing the inconsistencies in the written portion of the show, they added inconsistencies to the visual portion of the show to give the series a consistent theme of incoherence, you know, rather than trying and failing to tell a normal, cohesive story. 10 out of 10. Out of 10. There's a second jump cut, except this one has lore implications. Ruby is behind Weiss. Ruby is in front of Weiss. Ruby is behind Weiss again. Now, if you're watching this scene with hindsight, you're aware that Emerald could have manipulated Ruby's perception, making her easier to pickpocket. But if you try to rationalize it against the jump cuts and the fact that all the huts on this side of the fairground changed, or like how they started here, jump cutted to here, and then jump cutted here in a different configuration after Ruby had her pocket picked, you're like, was that all Emerald? Or what?
What's up, Em?
Now, I really can't help but think, no, he's M, I'm E. But if you ever need help, you can always remember the team mnemonic. C-M-E-N. It's not hard.
I need an adult.
Remember what I said about villains having dick names? Seriously, how do you upgrade Team Cream to Team Semen and not have James Ironwood be a bad guy? They brought Neo back. Why? For fan pandering. No, I mean for what narrative reason? What does she do?
The last of the heavy lifting is being taken care of, thanks to our clever little friend.
Oh, the entire plot. Wow. Bringing her back into the story was also a waste because her power is arbitrarily similar to Emerald's. But I'll get to that later. Now, there's a trend in the dialogue, and that's characters saying how great the previous fight scene was.
Just left the stadium after watching your amazing fight.
Like self-aggrandizement in its purest form. Now, if you've made it this far into the video, or have eyes, you might have noticed that that last fight was abysmal. Now, when a show has 12 and 3 half fight scenes, and 3 and a half of them are good, and another 2 are, like, passable, that's not a good thing, because no matter how much I could harp on the shaky story relevance or stupid mechanics of the fights in previous volumes, they at least looked good. Volume 1 had one fight that didn't look good. Volume 2 had 2 fights that didn't look good. Volume 3 had like 3 fights that actually looked good. And the closest they ever came to diegetic masturbatory self-aggrandizement was when Lai Ren said this at the end of Volume 2.
Team Ruby has always performed exceptionally in the field.
Volume 3 has...
Watching your amazing fight!
You all earned it after that battle.
One of my favorite students!
Now that was a match!
And with an amazing upset!
You two were incredible out there! Amazing! Oh my gosh, you guys were super crazy awesome!
I dig it.
Good job, you two.
Yeah!
Your performance has been exemplary.
What a way to kick off the finals!
Almost like they're overcompensating for something they predicted was going to be a disaster. And they were right. One more coincidental self-awareness point. Who they actually ended up sending to the doubles round was really smart.
The heiress and the bimbo.
Yang and Weiss have a lot of potential synergy, because Weiss can immobilize the enemy, and Yang can beat them up. I mean, I say potential because we all saw the fight earlier in this episode. Much to my chagrin, however, when they get to the 2v2 round, they split up and fight rather inefficiently anyway. Why doesn't Weiss lay down uneven mounds of ice so that Neon can't skate over them? Effectively taking her out of the fight long enough for Yang to give this guy the rusty trombone. Trumpet. But now, Blake, is this old fuck racist or what? Weiss's card gets declined and this asshole takes Blake's food instead of the girl who can't pay? Does this guy have experience with Blake dining and dashing? Or does he just require that Faunus bring white people to pay for them? Yang is openly surprised when Weiss offers to pay.
Aw, Weiss, what's the occasion?
So clearly they were all expecting to pay individually, so why does this asshole think Blake is more likely to skip out on the bill than Weiss, who demonstrably cannot pay for her own meal? This is pissing me off. I really hope somebody at the end of this volume decides to fucking murder every human in Vale. On a lighter note, Ren talks too much this volume.
Nora, that's disgusting.
Now, this isn't specifically a comment on the amount of lines he has, even though he has more lines in this volume than in the first two combined. This is a comment on the type of lines he has. The thing that makes this so uncanny is that 20 weeks passed between volumes 1 and 2, and only a week or two passed between volumes 2 and 3.
Volume 1 was semester 1, volume right. 2 semester 2. There was like 2 weeks off, and then everybody came back for the tournament.
Yeah.
Okay.
Which, if you weren't paying attention,
classes start back up tomorrow.
Means that the second semester at Beacon only lasted 5 days.
Every day out there is worth a week in this place.
Technically, they spent a week in this place. And 2 days out there, so by crow's math, the semester lasted 3 weeks. Either that, or 19 weeks passed between episodes 4 and 5, and nobody fucking noticed? So for Lai to remain the socially awkward stoic who spoke in direct and concise language, even to the person he's known for the longest time for the entirety of the first and second semester at Beacon, to become the type of person who would crack jokes, initiate conversations, participate in banter, and make sarcastic quips...
Sure, why not?
Is something worth criticizing. I still like Nora, though.
Oh, aiming at the enemy!
That hasn't changed. It is worth noting the impressive amount of restraint they showed, not having her say boop or Queen of the Castle this season. I mean, Nora was on point all season.
Come on, men! Let's go back to the fairgrounds!
I mean, this is a real emotional moment. Not like Yang losing her arm that plays on, what, the human emotion to... be bilaterally symmetrical? No, I'll take the desire to see your friends happy any day.
Practice what you preach, Pura.
And it's shit like this that makes me want to see more of her, so I was a little disappointed when they said in the commentary that they cut her second fight.
Originally, we actually wanted to show Pura and Nora versus Sun and Neptune.
Mm-hmm. Despite the track record of fights this volume, why couldn't they have cut one of these garbage fights? Hell, why couldn't they have cut all of these garbage fights and turned them into 2 decent ones? Ruby is about good action and bad writing.
Look around, kid. I've got this town running scared.
This season is about bad action.
Hit him with a hammer.
Got it.
and still bad writing.
I don't know if you've noticed, but things are getting a lot scarier out in the world.
Shane was right about you. And he was even responsible for the bad action. But moreover, he was right about you.
We should be looking forward to a fight with actual guidelines and not, well, murderers.
Now here's a fun challenge. Was this line A, a plot hole, B, a retcon, C, cuttingly self-aware commentary on the presentation of events from the end of last volume, or D, just a regular line, stop overanalyzing everything, you obviously have never even seen one episode of Ruby, and you're just hating on it because it's popular, it has a plot, and the action is good. Because there's a compelling case to be made for the first three of those four options. By the wording of that sentence, with murderers could mean a fight alongside murderers. Because if you watched Volume 2, I'm sorry. No, really, I'm sorry. But you should recall that Blake and Yang directly killed people through their actions.
Dude, that guy's dead.
In self-defense, to be sure, but it's the second closest thing to a murder we get in this show. And let's not forget about Glinda and her mass murder, lest we be doomed to repeat it. So the potential is there for Pure's line to be a jab at the remarkably unheroic nature of our main cast. But the first closest thing to a murder we get is Mercury and Tuxin. But Pura doesn't know he killed Tuxin, right? Because if she did, why isn't she doing anything about it? So if you decided to pick D, just remember, Team Juniper never actually fought against murderers. A Grimm can't be considered a murderer, because murder refers to one human being killing another in a premeditated fashion. You know, homicide, homo, man. And there were no White Fang members at the breach. So Pura is describing something that didn't happen. But there's enough evidence later in the volume that points towards this being part of some massive season-long retcon.
Perhaps Ospen felt as though defeating Atlas in the tournament would help people forget his colossal failure to protect Vale when the Grimm invaded its streets.
Now, I don't know about you, but I don't recall a scene like that in the previous two volumes. I mean, the Grimm breach from the end of Volume 2, But Cinder is trying to pass off sending students to solve the problem in the most anticlimactic way possible as a colossal failure, instead of as a resounding success? The Grimm fight at the end of Volume 2 was so boring it completely delegitimized the potential threat the Grimm posed. Coco, one of Ospin's students, ended the breach with one sweep of her minigun. And that's the opposite of failure. Is Cinder talking about something that happened in the week or two that passed between the volumes that wasn't shown to the audience, yet referring to it like it's something we're supposed to know about?
Colossal failure to protect Vale when the Grimm invaded its streets.
I don't know what the fuck you're talking about.
Grimm invasions, violent extremists, a destructive sociopath.
Grimm invasions? As in plural? Okay. Extremists and sociopaths as well. So there was a fight that happened between Ruby, Juniper, Grimm, extremists, and a sociopath that happened after the Volume 2 finale that the audience didn't get to see.
Violence hasn't dropped since Roman got nabbed. It stopped. Completely.
This show is frighteningly worthless. Volume 1 was about Roman Torchwick failing to steal dust. Between volumes, he magically stole all of the dust. Then he used that dust to facilitate a breach that failed so hard to serve its intended purpose that in between Volume 2 and 3, they made up an entirely new, arbitrary, more dangerous breach, which Ospin's students failed to contain, and hope no one caught on. I mean, they reference this breach where Torchwick got arrested. Crow confirms that nothing happened after that breach, except most of the characters are referring to an event that wasn't depicted in the show. At what point does the average viewer of Ruby have their entire worldview shattered? Here we are, nearing the end of the first episode of Volume 3, and not only have we had the worst animated and directed action sequence in the entire show, but here,
not, well, murderers.
A single line of dialogue completely invalidates everything that happened in the first two volumes. Hold on. Roll a clip.
I'm not good at a lot of memory-related things. It's really, really bad.
They have so much contempt for their audience that they don't even bother to veil.
Even if you know how a story ends, that doesn't make it any less fun to watch.
That line was written by a guy who will mark any question as a spoiler question and refuse to answer it on those grounds.
No spoiler questions! Great start!
How does an unpopped kernel get that close to the top of the tub?
No spoiler questions!
These guys know so little about movies that they even fucked up popcorn. now that we have the entire first two volumes effectively retconned out from underneath us, we have a whole lot more tournament before we even begin to address it. The silver lining is that you've probably been broken by episode one, so the rest of the fights don't even seem so bad by comparison. I mean, just look how much damage this rifle does. No, not you, Ren, you're in the middle of a fight, you should be focusing. How does someone miss by that much from that angle? Then they all hide behind a rock, because that matters. Except for Pura,
what do we do?
Who is sticking her big dumb red head out for the world to see. This is the most explicit clue we get that she is in fact suicidal. Then they realize that rocks made shitty cover, or they forget about the sniper, and then one of the announcers shows a clear bias towards a combatant.
One of my favorite students.
And the other puts her at a significant disadvantage.
Yes, Miss Valkyrie's semblance, let's have produce.
Like, a massive fucking disadvantage. He just told her opponent, who she is currently fighting, the way that she is going to try to beat him. Could you imagine if anyone had done that to Pura at any point?
Why she's known as the Invincible Girl. She just happens to fight a lot of dudes with metallic weapons.
Her career would be over. I mean, if people found out she was susceptible to non-metal weapons, or shooting her in the back of the head when she's only 3/4 of the way behind cover, do you think she would have won the Mistral Regional Tournament so many times in a row if it was a fair fight every time? He doesn't say this guy's semblance at any point. And by the way, he's surprised.
What?
The combatant's semblances aren't supposed to be common knowledge. How the fuck can Ooblet get away with this? I've bet $100 on Team Bronze, and I'm regretting that decision. By the way, the redhead uses magnets, the one in the green tunic gets tired very easily, and I wouldn't worry too much about the blonde because he's a terrible fighter. But he's insecure about his place in the Huntsman Academy, so use that against him! I mean, seriously, what if they had done that to Emerald, and just outed the bad guy's entire plan? And then Nora hits him in the dick, because honestly, who would expect her to fight fair after getting her power outed like that? But like, seriously, why doesn't she pick the thing up and shock herself with it? Why doesn't she have any way to activate her semblance on her own? I mean, I fully doubt this is intentional, but it kind of makes me like her a little bit more. It fits in with her happy-go-lucky nature, and it makes me think she doesn't take winning very seriously. Like she puts herself at a disadvantage to make the fights more fun. Or that she's so confident she figures the odds that she'll lose a fight are about the same as the odds that she'll get struck by lightning. And if that happens, you better watch your dicks! But much like the last fight, the whole enemy team stood in a single file line waiting to get hit for one massive elimination. That's because a large section of this fight was dedicated to doing the thing that they tried to do last volume.
In Volume 2, Monty really wanted to do the team attack names.
Yeah.
As kind of a shout-out to shippers.
Yeah, when Monty does it, it's cool. When John does it, it's not so cool.
You mean suck? Yes, that's exactly what I mean. Because while Team Juniper is discussing who exactly gets shipped with who,
Flower powers Ren and Nora. Ren brings the flower, Nora brings the power.
These guys are all politely waiting their turn to attack. I mean, this sniper, Mao Zedong, no relation, could easily get a headshot on this sedentary bitch. She fired a warning shot at Lai, and failed 2 clean headshots at Pura. Maybe it's because she has enough respect to not take advantage of the situation, as if it would be unfair to gain the upper hand on your opponent because they literally forgot what they were doing.
I'm not good at a lot of memory-related things.
We're in the middle of a fight!
I think he means that we're all in the middle of a fight.
Excuse me?
I think he means...
Oh, wow, did you blow that line? I think you did. Hey, Chuckles, do you want to redo that take? You want to hop back in the booth there? No? That's the take you're going to go with? Okay.
Well, Vacuo fans are sure to be hurting after that one, but this next round will have them on the edge of their seats.
Yes, indeed, Barney. Hurting like a bitch. Now let's cut to the coverage of the Grimm crawling at their doors because they had the poor judgment to feel strongly about a sports game. If Team Indigo were to lose their next match, their friends and family back at home will almost certainly die. Now, without further ado, let's get back to the somehow even more fucked up version of the Hunger Games.
So, when Miles and Carrie sit down to write, do they do drugs? Or are they naturally this incompetent? How does the culture of Remnant function the same way Earth does, with its worship of competitive sports?
The creatures of Grimm are lured towards negative emotion.
How has that ever been part of the culture if humanity has been dealing with large swaths of the population getting fucking wiped out for feeling bad ever since the dawn of recorded history? How do they hold a tournament where, by its very nature, 3/4 of the world's population are going to be put at huge risk? Why do they hold this tournament again?
To ensure that the world's huntsmen would never settle
for mediocrity.
Fuck you!
The Vital Festival Tournament was designed to test the strengths of the Kingdom's warriors in a safe and friendly competitive environment.
Safe for who? If you have commentators glibly remarking about how
Vacuo fans are sure to be hurting after that one,
then you are putting people's lives in danger. Do these girls get that two Shade losses back to back might seriously endanger people on the outskirts of Vacuo? Wouldn't that stress them out? Wouldn't that make them more likely to lose? What if people who didn't care started putting two and two together? Like Bronze lost and Indigo is fighting next? Oh crap. Now they're stressed out hoping Indigo wins, all so that the idiots watching the tournament don't attract Grimm with their negativity. Doesn't that line make Cinder's plan seem almost unnecessary at this point? Like her plan only targets Alice and Beacon because she doesn't need to twist the knife in Shade or Haven because their teams are terrible? Remnant doesn't have a culture, it's just Earth with a bunch of extra crap tacked on. It's not incorporated smoothly. I don't believe for a second that this place would function like this. They wouldn't have the Hunger Game Olympics, they'd have the fucking Puppy Bowl.
It's just really freaking cute.
Not this shit. Alright, what are we dealing with in this fight?
What are you doing?
Oh, you know, just gain the higher ground.
On the enemy's side?
This is entirely stupid. Why does Sun yell at Neptune for outflanking his opponents at the beginning of the match? Neptune has the high ground, with a ranged weapon, deep in their area, they're surrounded. If they try to get away from Neptune, they'll be pushing away from their home field advantage. If they try to keep their home field advantage, they'll have to scatter. Neptune can't fight near the water because he's afraid of it.
Neptune's afraid of the water.
Regardless of why Blake knows this, Sun probably told her whatever. This is the best possible opening for Team Sun. What's wrong with Sun for not being able to detect the tactical advantage of surrounding your opponents? You know, maybe Sun as a team leader shouldn't have skipped his entire first semester of combat school. But then Team Indigo yells,
"Open fire!"
Which is a weird thing to yell, because only one of them has a weapon that fires. Now why is open fire even a term in Remnant? Because they have dust. Fire was just one of many elements that their projectiles could function with. They didn't need to light gunpowder on fire to cause an explosion that pushes a metal ball through the air towards their enemies. They could just pick up a rock and rub it on their nipples and yell lightning tits. Why isn't lightning tits what they yell when they start shooting, Answer me! But instead of opening fire, they actually turn tail and run away from Sun and friends. I mean, they might be Sun's friends, I don't know. He did ditch them to go hang out in Vale for an entire semester that he could have spent learning about flanking maneuvers. So these guys went to their first semester of combat school without a team leader, and when they finally reunite to him, he chastises his teammate for giving them a huge tactical advantage.
Yeah, he's dumb.
Why is Sage just watching her do this? In fact, why did Team Sun just stand there while Indigo had their backs to them? The fight had started at that point, so what were they doing? So after Sage gets eliminated, this fight gets a lot better.
In the middle of my fights, it's like it's easier when you have like X amount of people, and this is like 8 people. It's like you gotta establish someone's KO for X amount of time.
A lot better than fucking garbage, putting it firmly into the not very interesting to talk about range. I mean, what am I gonna say? Characters in the background do shit, and I appreciate that. There were a couple of cool shots. And with that fight ends our third of three multiple eliminations where characters stand in a single file line and all wait to get knocked out at once. I mean, did they not hear Neptune say,
"Just get out of the water!"
Because Sun did. Now we're introduced to the element of the show where the single solitary fuck the staff were contractually obligated to give went. Not the action scenes anymore. They've been dumped off the Rooster Teeth priority list like their standards of writing quality were 3 years ago. But Crow is the best part of the volume, and most likely the whole show. And I'm not gonna lie, a fair bit of that was because he was introduced by showing as much hatred for these first three shitty fights as I did.
Now that was a match.
That was a mess.
His performance is top-notch, and he's played by a professional, so I should expect no less. The cinematography in his introductory shot are all canted Dutch angles, which really kind of exemplify that he's a drunk. But mostly it... Sorry, I got distracted by that mustache. Most impressively, he builds up a fight as if it's gonna make all three of the other fights of this volume look like shit. These other three fights already look like shit, and I didn't really get the impression that they made these three fights terrible on purpose just so they could build up the one in episode three. They were a little more humble towards the two fights in episode two.
This truly was a point where the animators were just really getting their sea legs, if you will, with fights.
This fight and the next one were definitely a learning curve.
But the same can't be said for the first fight in the volume, which was significantly worse than either of those fights. Well, I mean, just listen.
It was amazing to see Team Ruby in such fine form again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It was such a welcome return just to, you know, after everything that...
What are we doing in episode one? Oh, a 4-on-4 fight. Like, yeah. Compared to stuff that we've done in the past, that was big. I don't think I've ever seen our team more pumped to prove that they were ready to do something great, and I think they did.
So if they thought that was the benchmark for quality, the fight that would have blown that one out of the water could have easily been an out-of-focus video of a thumbless child banging two Barbie dolls together. But what we got was, without exaggeration, a little bit better than that. Now, despite this being my favorite fight scene in the whole series by a long shot, it does have its flaws. For instance, some of the cuts are cropped in too close. And there are a couple shots where Winter is straight up not animated at all. It only works in Kill la Kill. See, they knew what they were doing. You guys don't. And obviously it makes everything that led up to the breach in Volume 2 even less forgivable. If people like this exist, how the fuck are there not at least a couple in the cities doing stuff? But that's trivial. The reason this is my favorite fight scene is because it feels like the two hit harder and faster than any other character we've seen fight before. These are supposed to be huntsmen in training. Teenagers. And yet Coco can demolish like 50 million Grimm in like 6 seconds. The skill ceiling for huntsmen seemed pretty disappointing. Like, the only way to improve was to increase the amount of perceived damage they were doing. Like, the interesting fights were the low-level ones from the red trailer. And the high-level fights were all like one-hit or multi-hits or this, like, hey guys, this is what you can look forward to. More lame fights! But 3 frames into this fight, you're like, oh, this is what we can look forward to. Winter moves fast like Ruby. I mean, a lot of characters move fast like Ruby, but you can almost tell that she'll be able to move even faster when she's a real huntress. And the lack of care Crow fights with by lazily dodging strikes, bowing, and moving with obnoxious flourish is immediately causing Winter to go on the defensive, all while drunk, is pretty cool. The stop and pop nature of the fights means that they're moving faster than the eye can see, while neither of them have a speed semblance, hopefully.
A lot of the message of this whole volume was that, like, these guys are on a completely different level.
This fight feels like, you know, I think that's the heart of it. This fight feels. There's a reason so many people think there's sexual tension between Winter and Crow, and that's because they fight with emotion. Like, oh, you hit me. Allow me to take this more seriously. And Winter got the first hit in, so she doesn't feel bad about using her semblance first. She's jealous and petty, which is why she attacked him after he put his sword away. She's not aware of her surroundings. She's thinking that Crow isn't taking the fight seriously and that he's gonna pay for it. But this fight put me in such a good mood that I felt like reading into this dialogue that at face value seems pretty stupid.
He started the altercation, sir.
That's actually not true. She attacked first.
Why doesn't Winter just say the truth?
Is that right?
If she's going to get in trouble, why doesn't she tell Ironwood that Crow started the fight? I mean, the thing is still in frame. Winter could just point and say, look, and all these people are just as shocked as I am that she didn't stand up for herself. Is this some weird form of communication between these two? Where, as the loser, she has to accept Ironwood's punishment because Crow subconsciously said so? So why is Winter defending herself to Glinda in the next scene?
He was drunk. He's always drunk.
The far more likely explanation is that Miles and Carrie didn't magically learn how to write dialogue for this one scene.
There was a sanction fight happening just around the corner at the Colosseum.
Just around the corner? You drunk motherfucker, the Colosseum floats. Exactly which corner are you referring to? And secondly,
that concludes the matches for today.
Now, there's something I gotta figure out about Winter's character, and allow me to put my detective's hat on for just a minute.
I'm not good at a lot of memory-related things.
Oh, all right. Winter is a graduate of Atlas Academy, and therefore a member of the Elysian military.
Atlas Academy has come under increasing amounts of scrutiny for the indoctrination of military lifestyle upon its students.
And her father is pissed at her for being in the military.
I may have been in a similar situation when I joined the military.
Mr. Schnee is also pissed at Weiss for going to Beacon.
You can either call him, beg for his money back, and explain once more why you want to study at Beacon over Atlas.
Which is not associated with the military.
The government and school are completely separate, can you believe it?
We see at the end he's perfectly capable of picking her up and bringing her home. But if that's the case, why did he even bother supporting Weiss through her first year? Why did he wait so long? See, it's not about having enough information. I know a lot of people are gonna say that. It's about having conflicting information. If he doesn't want his daughter to go to the military, why does he have a problem with Weiss going to Beacon? Is he just a plot-convenient ponce? Sire two Sundures? Own slaves? Grow a mustache? That's it?
Leave us.
Great job, guys. You did it. Well done. Other than that, and the non-animated slap, wait, how does Oru work again? Does it go around the bump on her head or what? The lead up to my favorite fight just so happens to be my favorite scene from the volume.
How appropriately underwhelming.
Thank you.
Thanks to Carrie's writing and Lindsay's ad-libbing.
A lot of that was Carrie's writing in this scene.
I ad-lib a lot.
I don't understand why some scenes are really good and so many others are so bad. Because when they write a good scene, it's not like it's good for Ruby. Because this is a parallel to the scene from Volume 1 where Weiss almost got herself killed because she was being stupid. Except we see it through the filter of someone who's not incredibly stupid and immature. Imitation is the highest form of flattery, but misunderstanding what you wish to imitate is the highest form of stupidity. Now, you can go back and watch Volume 1 with the added depth of Weiss is a horrible racist in Volume 1, so you can't really go back and rewatch Volume 1 with any extra hidden depth, because Volume 1 Weiss isn't Weiss, because her personality got completely retconned at the beginning of Volume 2.
You're discriminatory!
I'm a victim!
Our business is operated in a moral gray area.
Yeah, that's the problem with retcons. They make the show unwatchable. Watching the whole show back to back, you kind of realize that she never actually grew as a person. She just magically stopped being racist. Well, let's just revel in socially awkward Ruby while Winter shows disgust for the first tournament fight.
Nor did I come here to watch my own blood fail so miserably in battle. I counted at least 3 strikes missed.
Missed strikes? What do you call it when she stands here with her thumb in her ass, letting this guy do whatever, and then she just completely fucks off in the next shot? Like, is that a missed strike? Oh well. I think it has to be lightning in a bottle that the two characters who participated in the best fight in the series are the two talking the most shit about the worst fight in the series.
You didn't like them? The Veil Kids? Or any of the rounds before that?
Wait a second. What the fuck?
It seems we have another astonishing bout ahead of us.
Wait, there were no rounds before the Veil Kids. The episode title is Round 1. Hey, wait, she never said unleave us.
Leave us.
What the fuck is up with this? Why are you oh, never mind. You know, in the middle of this fight, Ruby approaches Weiss from the wrong direction. Beacon is on the side of a cliff, remember? I mean, like, in the wide here, there's no alternate path back from the landing dock to the other side of the walkway. So did Ruby just take a lap around the horizon for fun? Cardio's important. Where did she cut in? I mean, holy crap. I guess the girl with the speed semblance would be the one to just run to the horizon and back for no reason. So Winter is introduced with the express purpose of being asked to leave.
Winter, leave.
So that Crow can explain what's going on to people who already know what's going on.
Despite what the world thinks, we're not just teachers or generals.
If they had left Winter in the room, the scene could have turned into a 5-way. I mean, Crow could have said the exact same line of dialogue directly to her. Then Ironwood could have told her to leave and reprimanded Crow for telling her all the exposition. Then Crow could have said, "Fuck you," and put a little Hello Kitty refrigerator magnet on his stupid metal forehead thing. But as it stands, it's just an unfunny version of,
"Jimmy, I am 18-year-old Black Dynamite, and you're my 16-year-old kid brother.
We know."
But it's more of this, "We're keeping secrets from the audience, hearty har har har" bullshit. Would it shake you to your core if I told you you can't carry a show on the notion that something interesting might happen at some point in the future? Could you imagine RVB like that? What if they had spent the first 3 seasons saying, "Ooh, something big and ominous is on the way, and we're going to talk about it in vague terms for no reason"? If that was the case, Bernie would still have his fucking day job. No, in Red vs. Blue, Tex showed up because Donut stole the flag. And Donut was able to steal the flag because two hazing rituals coincided with Tucker and Church gawking at their new tank. In Ruby, nothing. Nothing happens because Miles can't write. When character actions lead into each other with a cause and effect relationship, it creates what we call a plot. And that's something the audience can care about. Ozpin lets Ruby into school 2 years early. Why?
I still wonder why Ozpin let me into the school early.
Apparently Ruby doesn't even know. What else happened? It's been 5 hours. Come on, something must have happened in 5 hours. Cinder hacked into the CTT, right. Are those two things related at all? No? Everything else might as well have not happened. And in fact, a lot of it didn't.
His colossal failure to protect Vale when the Grimm invaded its streets.
This isn't storytelling.
Our enemy is here.
We know.
This isn't like a long play or a slow burn. Like winter is coming in Game of Thrones. Miles refers to this scene as a plot bomb.
It's time for a tiny little plot bomb.
Yeah, I think we did all right with it.
But I wonder what he thinks plot means. Because nothing is happening here. The audience isn't being given new information.
Your little infiltrator isn't just another pawn.
We're just having the fact that the characters know more than us reinforced. We don't need to know that. We need to see events occur.
A guardian is a symbol of comfort.
Now, there's an interesting sentiment here about the difference between Atlas and Vale's politics.
But an army is a symbol of conflict.
This is a wildly presumptive statement for Ozpin to make. Armies could easily be seen as the dissolution of power amongst the citizenry, while guardians could be seen as authoritarianism or an oligarchic power. In his lines, however, Ozpin never acknowledges that he understands that Vale and Atlas are different.
We definitely wanted people from these different kingdoms to have differing philosophies and...
Nobody ever says that Atlesians might be more comfortable knowing that their power is in the hands of a large organized group of people who are no different from they are. While all the hippie, liberal SJW faggots in Vale are content in the knowledge that this one teenage girl is going to give them all the protection they need. What about the other two kingdoms? Minstrel and Vacuum or whatever. Doesn't Minstrel have an army composed of or bolstered by Grimm?
Giant Nevermore!
Wouldn't they think something like, why are all these pussies worried about Grimm at all? Don't they know that it's counterintuitive to their survival? And Vacuo, I guess nobody really cares about them because their teams are losing the tournament, and as a result, Grimm are already overrunning their city streets. Oh wait, you mean to tell me that out of 8 finalists, we've got 2 from each kingdom? Can you spell rigged? Why does Ironwood summon this hologram?
If this is the size of our defenses, what is it we're expecting to fight?
Big talk coming from a man training a school full of superheroes. Well, training is a strong term.
Are there any questions?
Yeah, sir?
Good.
So is school. And so is super. And, you know, heroes, actually.
All right, every word.
Much more than just a man.
I mean, if Jean is one of the top 12 students at your school, how do you justify getting out of bed in the morning? At the end of the volume, when Beacon is being overrun by Grimm, only students who participated in the tournament are helping fight him. Like this girl. Seriously, where the fuck are her weapons? I mean, did they forget?
These institutions' sole purpose is to train the next generation of huntsmen.
This is a member of the freshman class. But what, were all the other students like, nah, I'm cool. I'm a cower over here in a corner.
A wonderful method in which to ensure that the world's huntsmen would never settle for mediocrity.
The White Fang holds rallies to pick up randos off the street who pose a legit threat to motherfucking huntsmen in training.
They're supposed to be the defenders of the world.
Why does the virus have a graphical tell? What if somebody noticed it? Like Mercury noticed this scythe.
Bad hair, used a scythe, and smelled like my dad after a long day.
Wait, hold on. Okay then. Yeah, it's kind of funny how they had the metal leg thing to explain why Mercury figured out Pyrrha had a magnet semblance. But now this? How are they gonna backpedal out of this one? So Emerald says...
I'll try not to get blood on it.
Which should be impossible for a number of reasons. First...
Aura is primarily used as a defensive mechanism, passively coating the wielder in a protective force field.
Two, you get eliminated if your aura falls below 15%. So if they hit their opponent enough times to make them bleed, they would be beating on an eliminated opponent, and that would be just plain unsportsmanlike. 3.
Aura is a manifestation of the soul.
If it gets reduced to 0, shouldn't that mean you don't have a soul anymore? Boy, it sure would be awesome if they explored that whole kerfluffle in the show. Now this fight is really bad for one reason. Kokome!
Inuyatsuhashi!
Okay, two reasons. And that's the absolutely disgusting reaction cutaways. And characters' continued propensity for standing still waiting for their turn to attack. I know in episode 1 there were 8 characters to keep track of, so like, how'd you forget Weiss was there? Oh, cause there are 7 other characters.
It's like it's easier when you have X amount of people, and this right. is like 8 people, it's like you just can KO people as soon as possible.
Yeah, 7's the perfect number.
Like you gotta establish someone's KO for X amount of time so that you can just get to like—
But in this fight, the characters who refuse to move are in frame. I mean, look at this shit. They added an animation where Coco checks her fucking nails while Yatsuhashi blocks a kick for her. She waits until Mercury lands before spinning up the barrels on her minigun. Now this combo is actually pretty good, but it ends in this horrible 4-second cutaway where Mercury thinks he smells toast or something. Because it is legitimately 4 seconds where Mercury has his hand on Coco's neck before just backing away. Then there's this. He pops behind them, there's a full second long reaction shot where Coco looks over her left shoulder, then in the space of one frame her body whips around 45 degrees to the right and her head does a full 180. The 5'10" Mercury grabs both of their arms and somehow manages to pass the 6'1" Coco over the top of the 7-foot Yatsuhashi. Now, if you're thinking,
that doesn't seem physically possible.
You're right, because not only does Coco phase through Yatsuhashi, hey, I thought Velvet was the one who was supposed to be able to phase through stuff. Oh, maybe she took a picture of Coco halfway through something and gained her powers. Right, that makes sense. Cool. But wait, if she could phase through stuff, why didn't she just phase out of Mercury's grip? Oh wait, he's not even holding on to her.
First a dismemberment, now this.
If he had crossed his arms the other way, he could have passed Yatsuhashi over Coco, which would have made a little more physical sense. Emerald has insane accuracy, and monstrous upper body strength. But that's par for the course by now, isn't it? Nevermores are weaker than trees. Except in Volume 1 they aren't. Except, fuck it. If they were able to show this footage on the Jumbotron, that means that the camera was directly in between Yatsuhashi and Mercury, meaning that Yatsuhashi got knocked out by a camera rig that Mercury kicked into him. How is that fair? I thought this tournament was supposed to be professionally run.
And with an amazing upset, Emerald and Mercury are victorious!
Amazing upset? Emerald and Mercury took a combined 1 hit. That was a landslide.
I was merely needed to oversee the transport of additional units to Vale.
Hey, I thought that was classified.
What are you doing here?
Classified.
Wait, why was something like that classified? People can see the units. It doesn't matter. Winter sets up important exposition for why everybody suddenly sucks at everything at the end of the volume.
It's fortunate those paladins were still in the prototype stage. Otherwise, your team may not have fared so well.
Then she sets up important exposition about how Miles and Carrie suck at delivering exposition.
We've been blessed with the World of Remnant shorts.
The power associated with a wielder's semblance is completely unique.
Every Shni has the ability to summon.
All semblances are unique. The video specifically designed to tell the audience the exposition said so. You've just been telling me I should be able to summon for all these years to make me feel bad because you know I can't do it. Because the lore of this series has already been established in that regard. You're a bitch, Winter.
We Shnees are unique.
Fuck you. How do you explain away getting the definition of unique wrong by calling something else unique?
What inspired Salem's design? Because it is very unique, and personally, I got like a Soul Eater vibe from it.
You know, I used to think Weiss and Winter were like Miranda and Orianna from Mass Effect 2. Cunts? Yeah. No, I mean clones. But for generations?
Every Shnee has the ability to summon. We have for generations.
That theory's out the window. So I'm back to my fallback. Miles and Carrie don't understand very basic words.
We edumacated.
I was defeated by the mere sight of the innkeeper's skirt length.
Which is significantly longer than Pura's. And Cinder's, but Cinder's not wearing her red dress. So, wait, what is she wearing?
How does she pee?
What did you just say?
Yeah, what even is this?
Nah, man, Band-Aids are cool.
Wearing
Sonic Boom.
I don't know what I was expecting.
He kind of looks like he might go like Palpatine or whatever. Yeah.
I still can't get over the fact that Miles just referenced the prequels of Star Wars in this.
But on top of not being very practical, her chest is wrapped up, but her boobs didn't even get smaller. In fact, they might even be bigger. What witchcraft is this? Wait, if her chest is wrapped, why can we see side boob through her tank top sleeve hole? Now, moving on from that slightly pervy tangent, Crow does finally let us know definitively what Huntsmen do.
Huntsmen that I could only assume had been hired by less than reputable people for less than respectable jobs.
As it turns out, whatever they damn well please. They all just get Huntsmen training and then get private jobs because they pay better? I called it! I mean, I also called that they die and teach. So Ruby's parents are both Huntsmen. One of them is a teacher, and one of them probably died in a field somewhere. But—
died like every other Huntsman in history!
Okay. I'm satisfied. It's weird when you hedge your bets and both of your guesses turn out to be right. So he just has this picture on him. It's not even creased. Where was he keeping it? Wait, why did he even bother taking it out if he knew he had to cover it up to avoid giving Yang mother-related PTSD? Why did he show them this? Didn't they both already know what their parents looked like? Then why did he cover up Raven's face? Wait, why have none of them changed clothes since graduation? Anyway, we get to another fight where the majority of the characters just stand in one place and it ends with a multiple elimination. Well done.
And victory goes to Penny and Seattle of Atlas!
Oh no, such brutality! This assault on a helpless student after the fight has been called by an official will not stand! Storm the arena with armed guards and arrest these brutal psychopaths at once for... Wait, why is nobody losing their shit over that? This kid with very little aura got hit in the head by a rock that was falling like super fast. He could have easily been killed. But instead of throwing the crowd into a panic of world-ending proportions, their mild roar escalates to outright cheering. Well, at least the bad guy's plan doesn't hinge entirely on the audience reacting with shock and horror to someone getting injured after a match has ended. It would sure be embarrassing for the writers if that was the case.
Could we have just a minute to talk?
Now, a lot of people like to joke that CL only gave Ruby and Penny 47 seconds instead of a whole minute, but in all likelihood, Penny just spent 18 seconds explaining this 5-second cutaway.
There was an incident with a magnet, but I was able to play it off.
Now, here's something. When you go through the commentary looking for, really, any information at all on how the show ended up in this state, and you end up hearing something like this.
We didn't get into much of a CL as we wanted to this volume.
I ended up kind of baffled. Like, the same way I felt after they said that Torchwick played a smaller role in Volume 1.
She played a much smaller role.
At a third of the way through the third volume of a show, a character has 3 lines and the writers are like, we didn't explore this character as deeply as we wanted to. Well, why the fuck not?
If we ever get a chance to, you better—
you're the fucking writer.
It's not like there's a glut of things happening in Volume 3, and then a character who you wish you had more time to explore? So? Cut the entire first 4 episodes. I mean, what was the point?
But yeah, CL, yeah. Very, very detail-oriented and—
Oh, is that it? What, the fact that she clearly Facebook stalks Ruby isn't enough?
Ruby Rose, 15, hails from Patch, leader of Team Ruby. Status? Questionable.
Isn't it called It's Complicated?
We have, you know, 60 characters.
Yeah.
This show has 60 characters.
I think we have 56 characters.
Jesus.
None of them do things. This show needs characters that do things. Not say things. Not talk about stuff that happened off-screen.
We put it to a vote.
Or didn't happen at all.
We've all faced way worse before.
And the stuff they do should cause, or at least enable, other stuff to happen. What was Seal gonna do? Anything? Was she going to sing Do You Ever? Do you ever forget my name? Was this character, who was unrelated to everything, suddenly gonna make the plot happen? Or was this just a missed opportunity to waste more of our time? Ah, look, a White Fang member! No, really, guys, there's a White Fang member right there!
All new recruits, please come forward.
Welp!
In this scene, Penny says that no one should know she's a robot.
Oh no, General Ironwood doesn't really want anyone to know.
Yeah, except for those two guards who she openly showed her metallic hands to.
Oh no!
There's this thing called continuity.
No, no, not in Ruby, there's not. And Port says,
"Our next match will begin in 15 minutes.
Instead of the last 2v2 match, because Ruby apparently knows that Weiss and Yang are up, even though the order is randomized.
Oh my gosh, that's right, it's time for—
Even though Cinder is controlling the order of the tournament. Wait, what the fuck? Penny is an acronym? But she has a last name in the credits. What does this acronym even stand for?
What the hell does Penny stand for?
It stands for
P-E-N-N-Y.
Thank you, Kay.
Wait.
It means that this will be even easier than we thought.
Cinder didn't know Penny was a robot until after the 2v2 matches were over? So, wait, what if she accidentally put Pura and Penny up against each other thinking it was no big deal? Wait, if Cinder's plan mostly involved pitting Atlas and Vale against each other, why did she put Atlas and Vale against each other twice in the 2v2 round? Wouldn't she want to hedge her bets by getting as many Atlas and Vale students into the final bracket as possible? If Cinder is rigging the tournament, why does she have two people from each kingdom in the top 8? How does that benefit her? Wouldn't it also have increased dismay in Vacuo if none of their huntsmen made it to the finals? Why did she put Yang and Weiss up against these two? They could have lost. What if Flint Cole wasn't a moron and decided to eliminate Weiss instead of turning his back on her and standing still, waiting for his turn to attack? Oh, for fuck's sake. Why are all the characters so incompetent? All of them. Without exception. The cleverness of an entire cast of characters is capped at the cleverness of your writers. Why doesn't Weiss use her ice powers to reduce Neon's mobility?
Also, was it technically the Super Saiyan that made her win, or was it the fact that she was just destroying the floor?
I think we should write Volume 3.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
Why doesn't Flint eliminate Weiss? Why doesn't Weiss remember what Yang's semblance is? Why don't the writers remember what Yang's semblance is?
It looks like Yang's angry, and you wouldn't like her when she's upset.
What? Did Rooster Teeth get a cease and desist from Funimation, Toei Animation, Fuji TV, and Akira Toriyama? So they decided that ripping off Marvel, which is now owned by Disney, would be a better idea? Great fucking job, you guys! Yang's semblance is so unique that it doesn't even function the same way twice in a row!
With each hit, she gets stronger, and she uses that energy to fight back!
Flint Cole is a perplexing character. If you pay any attention to his fight at all, you'll end up perplexed. Listening to the logic behind casting his voice actor.
Their frontman is a really funny dude. He's a really cool guy.
So, naturally.
Naturally.
Naturally! Okay.
You'll let him play a character with no funny lines. But they still claimed his audition was very funny.
He auditioned, and he did a great job.
Yeah, he did.
And it was really funny.
Till your father's company ran him out of business.
Crumbling middle class in Atlas.
That was a gutsy move, Schnee. I dig it.
Sportsman-like conduct. Get a load of this guy. Why is any of that supposed to be funny? Why is the consideration for casting this particular character the actor's ability to rap comedically?
Also named Flint.
He goes by Flint Flossie.
I mean, don't get me wrong, he did a good job, but it wasn't funny. And based on the lines he read, I can't imagine it was supposed to be. But the way the character fights is one of those things where the more you think about it, the more upset you get.
This is one of the most fun fights I think we got to write.
His semblance is to become four people, and he decided that all of them must face the same direction and hope Weiss was stupid enough to pass directly in front of him? Thankfully, she is.
Watch where you're going!
So, he looks up at his aura and decides to stop using his semblance. You might think this is because using semblance takes up aura.
Semblance is a term used to describe the projection of aura.
But that can't be true, and not just because of everything said in World of Remnant. It's because at the end of the fight, when he is 1% away from elimination, he uses his aura anyway and doesn't immediately get eliminated. So why does... Why any of it? Why does he check his aura? Why does the information on the aura board make him turn his semblance off? Why doesn't he attack Weiss? When he looks over and sees Neon having absolutely no trouble chipping away at Yang, why does he shift focus to her? Where does Weiss's rapier go? Why does he turn his back on his opponent? Why does Weiss stop him from hitting Yang? Doesn't she know how her semblance works?
She has to take the damage in order to be able to get it back.
How does Weiss tackle through four people?
It appears we have a double knockout on our hands!
In fact, it looks as though Miss Shinee's aura has been completely depleted!
How are the announcers unaware of the aura levels of the contestants? How does Yang's semblance activate anyway? But the worst part about this fight, The most unforgivable thing is that when Neon Genesis Epilepsy says never miss a beat, it isn't even on beat.
Why do you suppose I just hurled a chair at your head, Neon?
But why isn't having your aura completely depleted a bigger deal?
Aura is the manifestation of our soul.
But it can be accurately measured, so it can't really be something abstract, right? I mean, how did they attribute the observable phenomenon of aura to the abstract concept of the soul? The relationship wouldn't go in that order, would it? I mean, they had sharp objects before they had philosophy, right? They must have known about the force that protected them from injury before they tried to answer existential questions about the nature of existence. How is one proof of the other if they don't have a functional correlation? And what would drive Remnant's philosophers to even relate them in the first place? Or do they even know what that word means? And with that, we've finally escaped the tournament arc. There are gonna be two more fights. One of them is good, the other is short. But what did we gain from this? Every 4-on-4 match ended with a 3 or 4 man elimination, and every tournament match was a main cast team up against randos. Except one, which was the bad guys versus some people who were presented as so overpowered they literally ruined the show. Just as I predicted they were going to ruin the show.
She's about to ruin the whole series.
They had to diminish the capabilities of Team Coffee pretty much to zero in order for the Grim Horde and the upcoming episodes to mean anything. Oh my god! A Nevermore! Quick! Coco, fire one bullet at it!
You know, I'd have to call in my locker, and my phone's on 3% battery, and I'm just not feeling it right now. You know, I'm trying to break in these new sunglasses. You know, it's just not a good time.
We have an even shakier understanding of why any of these people are competing in the tournament. We still don't know what they get for winning.
You be sure to win one for Beacon, okay?
And we still don't know why any kingdom would willingly compete in a tournament where there's a 75% chance that they'll lose, causing their entire TV-owning populations to be put at risk.
Vacuo fans are sure to be hurting after that one.
Combatants threaten each other before matches.
I'll try not to get blood on it.
I can't promise you'll leave without a scratch.
I won't be the one bleeding.
It is peace that has served to shepherd humanity on its ascension to greatness.
Neon purposefully tries to piss off Yang.
Hey, why don't you? That's what you sound like.
Reese is pissed that she lost by ring out.
Safe and friendly competitive environment.
How does any of this make sense in a world where getting upset is a biological weakness?
But they don't give out medals for almost.
What the fuck does Crow mean they don't give out medals for almost? This is a society where participation medals would actually save lives. If you're inventing a world, you should at least have a rudimentary understanding of sociology.
Geography determines culture, and culture determines your people, and people are part of your story, and that's the most important thing.
Yeah, geography. But not monsters that maul entire villages to death for getting sad. Those don't influence your cultural development. Only two new relevant characters, arguably relevant characters, showed up during the first half of this season, for reasons unrelated to the tournament.
What fight are you here for?
That one.
The only thing Winter did was tell Weiss that the World of Remnant videos all lied to us. And the only thing Crow did was tell us what Huntsmen do and be generally entertaining. The only arguable takeaway from the tournament is that Coco and Yatsuhashi suck, which goes counter to the Breach episode, which apparently never even happened, so whatever, and that Nora is more useful than Pura, which is about to be contradicted in 3, 2, 1.
It comes as no surprise that they've chosen you to move on to the final round of the tournament.
So, we're in the plot now, which probably should have been the plot from way back in Volume 1, but...
Truth be told, the Maidens were not an idea from the very, very, very beginning of Ruby.
We talk about that a lot. It was like, we knew from the very beginning we wanted X to happen. This was not one of those things.
Between Volumes 2 and 3, Monty had an idea for something that he kind of wanted to change about the original story, and it was this idea of these Maidens.
Which raises the question of what Cinder's plan was.
We have big plans for you, Roman.
Like, was it actually just to cause a Grim invasion? To what end? But I'm getting ahead of myself. The Maiden subplot is dumb. That's it, actually. Review over.
You know what to do.
Have you chosen your guardian yet?
Maidens choose themselves. I simply believe I found the right candidate.
Well, Ozpin, we all know that the Maidens choose themselves. That's just obvious, silly. But in the very next episode, Crow and Ironwood talk about forcibly cramming a soul into an underage girl.
And we believe we found a way to capture it.
Capture it? and cram it into something else.
Here's an interesting point.
But we had to now go back a little bit and go like, okay, now how's this fit into what we already have?
Before the seasonal maidens were ever an idea, they wrote characters named Summer, Winter, and Fall independently of the idea that there would ever be characters related to those seasons. Even though characters aren't supposed to be related to those seasons.
There was a lot of misconception that, like, if you're the Fall Maiden, you can only do Fall-related powers, but that's not the case. You just straight up do magic.
In that case, how does anyone actually know this is the Fall Maiden?
But we definitely also wanted to play up. She kind of uses nature a lot to her advantage.
Yeah, as opposed to the other three seasons, which don't have any nature at all. Why would superheroes, who are super even compared to the superheroes that they train in every high school around the kingdom, kept secret?
Why not tell everyone?
And the silver-eyed people too.
You're special the same way your mom was.
That implies it's genetic, doesn't it? There should be long lines of these silver-eyed motherfuckers who get, like, parades and constantly laid.
The creatures of Grimm, the most fearsome monsters mankind had ever encountered, were afraid of those silver-eyed warriors.
There are people, human beings out there, who make Grimm scared. And they, whoever they is.
The Osluminati, as people call them now.
Fuck you, Yellow Brick Bunch is better. That implies a way better connection to the Wizard of Oz.
Sometimes I'm not even sure he has a heart.
If I only had a heart.
But why are they keeping these people a secret?
From what we understand, it used to be common knowledge. Those hungry for power hunted them with the hope of inheriting their strength.
That's a stupid answer!
The ones that succeeded weren't exactly the kind of people you'd want to have unimaginable power.
Maiden power is actually pretty imaginable.
Who are you? We're still the same teachers and headmasters you met when you arrived at Beacon.
Except that I'm not a teacher, and these two don't work here. So I can see how you might be a little more confused than you were before. Should I even point out the jump cuts anymore? I'd love to learn that it's actually like an inside joke amongst the animators. Hey guys, this script doesn't make any sense, so let's remove all visual continuity from the editing. Glinda slowed down so much that Crow and Ironwood managed to pass her, and those two shuffled around each other while passing Glinda, and Glinda drifted heavily to the left before stopping and turning around. Why didn't they just show her
already stopped
and waiting for Pura? It's weird how Crow talks like a normal person.
How does the power choose?
Through a series of stupid and convoluted rules.
But Glinda goes off like she memorized a passage from a particularly pretentious textbook and has been waiting her entire career to recite this verbatim.
The maidens have existed for thousands of years. But much like in nature, the seasons change. No two summers are alike. When a maiden dies, her power leaves her body and seeks out a new host, ensuring that the seasons are never lost and that no individual can hold onto power forever.
I don't know if you've noticed, but things are getting a lot scarier out in the world.
No, I hadn't noticed, Crow.
This is also cool. This is the first time we've ever seen an area outside of a kingdom, excluding Mountain Glen.
Thanks for letting me know.
Tensions are high. The Grimm are growing stronger, more prevalent.
God, what would I do without you, you magnificent drunkard written into the story at the last possible moment to explain to me, a lowly audience member, exactly what's going on and how I should be feeling about it. Because, you know, there's no other way to express that information to the audience.
Congratulations, you now have to have 6-7 characters in a scene, and there's a lot of information to get out all in one go.
It's really a masterfully executed screenplay that can tell an audience how they should be feeling by way of a character telling another character about things that neither they nor the audience have any idea about.
It was really stressful. I remember worrying, like, is it going to feel like it came out of nowhere and blah, 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 and I don't know, maybe it does, but...
How do we impress upon the audience that the situation is getting desperate? Well, we could always depict some of the events we're having characters refer to. For as many times as I call the writers incompetent, or stupid, or retarded, I can't bring myself to believe that if they were independently capable of coming up with the conclusion that they should be writing the scenes about the story they're trying to tell, that Ruby would ever have gotten to such a situation.
And now we can really start to tell this big story and this big world we've been excited about for several years now. So the end of Volume 3 is kind of like the end of Act 1.
Who the fuck told them things don't happen in first acts? It doesn't make sense. I need a moment of silence.
We can't transfer Amber's power to you, but we can give you what those powers are bound to.
Her aura.
No surprise, They're suddenly trying to play up the importance of Aura, right in between being so cavalier with Weiss's 10 minutes ago and being equally cavalier with Mercury's 4 minutes from now.
Look, it's Zero.
Bomb, bomb, bomb.
Zero.
After the only fight in the volume where nobody stands still like a jackass.
There's actually multiple shots in here that were started by him and then Shane took and finished out.
How did he know that this would leave her with 16% aura? Even if he somehow managed to calculate how much aura she had and how much damage he would do, what if she failed to dodge one of these things? What if she used her aura for some other purpose? What if she stubbed her toe before the fight? What if she didn't block that kick? What if Mercury's aura ran out one hit earlier? He'd end up like this guy. Or what if Yang fired one more time? I mean, that would have worked out fine for Cinder's plan, but like, not the other way. Why does everyone get worked up over this, especially when it's no different from any of the other hits she landed on Mercury after he fell below 15% aura? In this barrage, she hit him 10 times. One of those was blocked, and one of those happened after his aura was completely broken.
What a way to kick off the finals!
So he was already clearly being beaten on after the match was over. Merc got absolutely mullered and Yang didn't care when she won the match. She didn't even care after she destroyed his entire soul, and neither did anyone else. The crowd is cheering, and what the fuck is with the late buzzer? Mercury could have very easily died. Mercury is standing so close here. Yang's perception is the only one being manipulated, because that's how Emerald Semblance works. Wait, what is she looking at? I mean, she looked right at the camera, but that's not at anything. She's looking away from Yang and all the action. Mercury isn't even in this wide shot when he was right there a second ago. Hold on, wait, she can run down to the arena with her weapons and everything? Who directed this shot? Why am I even surprised? Okay, back to the point. How did Mercury manage to lose all of his aura while the crowd is seeing him over here? Yang beat up nothing while Mercury was sitting over here with no aura, and luckily Yang walked right over to where he was? Or did the crowd watch Yang beat him up and then see Yang walk away and see Mercury run in front of her, take a knee, and stand up before she could hit him? Wait, why are they showing this again on the monitor?
Cut the cameras!
It couldn't have been Cinder's plan to have this shown on repeat. She needed them to not find out about the fact that their feed got hacked until the next match, so why? Why does this even have an effect on the Grimm? Nothing has been so devastating as someone getting hit after a match was called? That was really the worst thing that happened all day? Why are the Grimm looking at the Colosseum? Are there really more distraught people in there than, say, watching the broadcast on TV everywhere else? Why does anyone think these pussy-ass robots can pose a threat to Yang? I mean, why do they have guns? They should be coming at her with, like, flowers and shit. Like, pretty please, will you cooperate with the nice law enforcement robots? Then they immediately cut it off to give us some backstory about the bad guys. Get it? Cause backstory? Cause there's no mark on her back yet? Cause... Okay, moving on. But in all seriousness, this is important information. For instance, Emerald doesn't have any volume control.
Don't. Unless, of course, you want them to hear you.
What do you want?
Shush, bitch, I thought you didn't want them to hear you.
I didn't do anything, just leave me alone.
Never mind. And Mercury killed his dad. And Adam goes from revolutionary leader to rapey ex-boyfriend in record time.
They have no idea how creepy this guy is.
What? He goes from this.
You are asking my men to die for your cause, a human cause. That is not an idea I am willing to entertain.
To this.
A lot of faunas didn't make it out of those tunnels. You still think the White Fang is gonna listen to us?
No, but they'll listen to me.
Just because Blake broke up with him. Bro, you need some counseling, and like a fleshlight or something. But all jokes aside, we learn a lot of information from this episode. For instance,
we'll assume Amber managed to make a bolt of lightning go from the clouds to the ground. This, according to Wikipedia, is the third most common type of lightning, and is still preceded by a channel of ionized air that would follow a body as it moves, because it remains the highest point in the vicinity. But that's digressing. It is likely this type of cloud is cumulonimbus, which at the average height is 9,000 meters high. Light travels at 299,792,458 meters per second, and lightning travels at about one-third that speed, which roughly equates to 99,930,819 meters per second. The light emitted by the lightning at its inception will reach the ground in 300,000ths of a second. The lightning will therefore reach the ground in about 900,000ths of a second. But Mercury and Emerald start accelerating away slightly before the light emitted from the lightning hits the ground, giving them 1,200,000ths of a second. In 1,200,000ths of a second, Mercury moved 81 centimeters. Assuming a constant rate of acceleration, he reached a top speed of 6,750 meters per second. We'll estimate Mercury's weight is average for someone his size at around 160 pounds, or 72.5748 kilograms. Meaning, when he dodged the lightning bolt, Mercury exerted 1,653,344,663 joules of kinetic energy at a 45-degree angle to the ground, making the total force of impact equivalent to over half a ton of TNT, raising the simple question of, how the fuck did Yang survive this? This means that Mercury accelerated at a rate of 112.5 million meters per second squared, which is 11,471,807.36 Gs. That means Mercury was able to survive over 100 times the gravity of the sun. Raising the question, how the fuck did this hurt Mercury?
So yeah, watching people in previous volumes lose consciousness because they hit the floor, which is just acceleration, loses all meaning when we see Mercury survive 100 times the g-force of standing on the surface of the sun. It makes me wonder about the meaning of life. Now, my biggest problem with this whole fight is the way it was directed. Emerald is manipulating what characters are seeing. So when we go back and watch episode 4 with hindsight, we're like, oh, that wasn't Neo, it was Emerald. Only to be met with the nagging question, why did they put Neo back in the story if she wasn't gonna do anything? Besides retconning Cinder's only contribution to Volume 2. The only reason Neo existed in Volume 2 was because Monty didn't want to animate Torchwick climbing into this vehicle.
And I was like, oh yeah, no, they could get in the ship and they get away. I was like, that's hard to animate. Let me just have them shatter into glass.
And it's almost like they didn't compensate for the fact that the bad guy's whole plan hinges on the ability for one character to manipulate another character's perception of events. And they arbitrarily introduced a character who can manipulate everyone's perception at once by creating physical illusions, and yet they stick with the original plan of relying on the inferior superpower.
One mind I can handle, but two is a stretch.
But that's only half of it. Every time we've been treated to seeing Emerald's power in action, the audience has been shown the manipulated party's point of view. In this scene, in order to make the, in order to make the volume have one less plot hole, but it is an important one nonetheless, Crow's perception had to be manipulated during this fight. But we can tell his vision is not being manipulated. Not manipulated, not manipulated, not manipulated, until the very end of the fight where he has clearly already seen all three of their faces.
Yeah. I'm trying to establish how Emerald's semblance works without explicitly saying it. Like, we've played a lot with camera and what you see in certain angles and what you don't see in certain angles.
The volume was directed by someone who does not value conveying information to the audience, and is written by someone who's
not good at a lot of memory-related things.
So in one out of four shots, Crow sees a blurry face, which, I mean, he must be aware isn't what faces actually look like. I mean, even if you want to say his perception was skewed the whole time, it wasn't manipulated before Emerald knew he was there. Cinder turns her head because she noticed him first, meaning before Emerald, meaning they are so bad at show don't tell, they even fuck up show. So from a distance, he can see that she does indeed have a regular face. Even if he's drunk,
he's always drunk.
He must know this isn't what faces look like.
Our enemy is here.
Including the one that makes me see shit that isn't there.
In the next episode,
so either you're lying or you're crazy.
You're forgetting that you yourself had your vision fucked with to see something that clearly wasn't there. What the fuck?
The only person stupider than Crow is Cinder. She's like,
he and I are working on a revolution of our own, but we can't do it without your forces.
But then she comes back like,
bruh, we killed your forces, so are you gonna give us your forces or what?
Bitch, you killed my forces.
Fuck.
Yeah, you really should have killed me and taken control of my forces. Well, that's not gonna help you now. You already killed my forces.
Quick, cut away from this flashback before the audience catches on.
They're not gonna catch on. Now here's another, the most important thing. This tournament has no system in place to prevent outside interference. None. Zip. Zilch. Nada. I mean, there's a force field to keep inside shit from going out, but that doesn't stop people from fucking with shit from the outside. How do they not have something, or I guess, how could they really, with semblances all being unique and all?
Completely unique.
I guess that's the first time that's worked out in their favor. But how can they not even consider that? I mean, there must be infinitely many semblances that could potentially trick someone into eliminating themselves from the tournament from outside in the stands. Pura could have done something like this, making Yang move her arm and fire. Neo could have done the exact same thing Emerald did. Glinda has telekinesis, for fuck's sake. Some blood-bending type semblance.
Whether it was an accident or an assault, it doesn't matter.
Having no security or prevention measures or even appeal process in place must mean that this has never happened before. In a population shitty and power-hungry enough to necessitate erasing the maidens from public knowledge just so someone doesn't try to murder Leaf Jesus and put the Cactor and Thornberry Raking Corporation out of business. Or whatever the fuck you do with maiden powers. In 40 instances, Cinder's group is the first one to try to cheat or rig the tournament?
Inconceivable!
That's the same as Blake being the first person to consider going undercover to infiltrate the White Fang. Everyone in Ruby is so fucking stupid.
We need to get this boy to a hospital. Grab a blanket.
Okay, two things. A blanket? Why?
We need to get this boy to a hospital. Boil some water. Rip up some blankets.
He broke his leg. He's not giving birth, Steve.
I can dream, can't I?
I hate working with you, Steve. And the second issue, there's not like a medical facility on this floating tournament thing. Really, the thought that somebody might get hurt while the children of Remnant are beating the ever-loving fuck out of each other for the amusement of the world at large never occurred to them. How did the planning meeting for this go? So we've got a thing where boiling hot steam shoots up from the ground, we've got some lava places, and a place where you can get struck by lightning.
Should we build a medical ward, you know, in case somebody gets hurt?
No.
I will deliver a baby one day.
God damn it, Steve, you're fired! Since we're already in the habit of asking stupid questions, why is Cinder doing her creepy douchebag voice?
We'll take good care of both of them.
And how does she get back on the shuttle after the door closes? Did they open the door back up? I imagined her standing outside like,
very funny, guys. Let me back in.
And then they fly away a little. And then she like walks up to it again. And then they fly away a little more. What was Emerald making these paramedics think they were seeing? If they touched Mercury's leg, it wouldn't matter what they thought they were seeing, they would feel metal. And his pants are still covering them up. And the blanket.
Grab a blanket.
Don't forget about the blanket. This was initially supposed to be a dismemberment.
First a dismemberment, now this.
Which they referenced in the script, but didn't change.
There's a thing in 9, I was, it's fine. She references a dismemberment.
Yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
No, you see, guys, they acknowledged it in the commentary.
Would you go to every theater to tell the audience? No.
So that makes it okay.
The audience see in the theater, good movie, bad movie, that's all.
A terrible tragedy took place this afternoon.
A terrible tragedy? Why are you reporting this?
Calling on any available huntsmen to aid in suppressing the spike in grim activity.
All available huntsmen to suppress the spike? Hey, fuckers, why don't you get one guy to go kill the fucking news cunt who's throwing the world into a panic over some guy who got hurt during a fucking superhero fight? How can this possibly be the first time this has ever happened? How is it possible that people react this way? How many times have I said something like Remnant cannot possibly exist with this type of culture? Their plan, their actual plan, was to make something mildly unpleasant happen and then let media coverage blow it way out of proportion until everyone dies? Holy fuck! Why is VNN on two different channels? What happens if something sort of messed up happens by accident? Don't bad things happen every day? Old man gets pickpocketed. This could happen to you next. Probably not, because you'll be dead from the Grim attack brought on by the fact that you're worried about getting pickpocketed now. Except now, you're even more worried about what happens if you panic. And now you're driving yourself mad, trying not to stress yourself out over the fact that getting stressed out will attract Grim and kill you. But you're strong of mind, right? You don't have to worry about that. But what about your neighbors? What if they aren't as calm as you? What if they're going to attract Grim, dooming you no matter how pleasant you keep your thoughts? Now here's Billy with the weather.
We're all gonna die.
More at 11, if you last that long. But as we all know, world building, crafting a unique, engrossing culture for your fictional world, designing a believable reality and having characters behave in a way that's consistent with the established lore of the series pales in comparison to making sure nobody mixes up a flathead with a Phillips head screwdriver.
Hold the phone, guys. Mercury has flathead screws on his legs, but he's using a Phillips head screwdriver.
Yeah, but a shout out to the community members. But so, well, how do you don't know that the interior screws aren't Phillips?
Wait, hold on.
But we're like, well, how do you know whether or not the interior screws were...
Really, Gray? The Ruby production staff has continuity errors in real life?
I appreciate their eye for detail.
An eye for detail? An eye for detail? You wouldn't know an eye for detail if it was used to tighten your fucking leg screws. How is this for an eye for detail? Neo, Mercury, and Cinder don't have anything to do with the Colosseum after this point in the volume. So why the fuck is Emerald the only one who got in the fucking ambulance and flew away? I'm aware that Cinder magically got in the ambulance during this scene, but if she was the one who took Mercury on board, leaving Emerald on the Colosseum, wouldn't that make infinitely more sense? If Emerald being at the Colosseum was so integral to your plan, why would you tell everyone that she wouldn't be there if you gain nothing from the lie?
I heard Mercury and his team rush back to Haven.
In fact, you lose a lot from the lie. No one had to go back to the Colosseum except Emerald. If she hadn't left in the first place, everything would have gone off just fine.
Until Cinder tells everyone that it's all just part of some evil plan. Because the next time we see Mercury, he's on the rooftop with Cinder.
How did he get off the fucking Colosseum if he wasn't supposed to be there in the first place? What, did he get on one of those shuttles standing next to some random fan going, "Hey, ain't you that guy who got punched in the leg?" No, you're thinking of someone else. Nah, you're the only one here without generic hair and clothes. You are the guy who got punched in the leg. How you walking right now?
No, that wasn't me.
Man, there are like 200 people on this shuttle, and you're gonna tell me I'm the only one who recognizes you from the final round of the tournament? Man. You should be grateful that you got called out on mixing up screwdriver props. Your script is fucking awful. Now, the most interesting thing about this whole event is how Barbara and Miles talk about Yang. Because to them, Yang is a completely different character from how she's been presented in the script.
You know, she's a very popular, very loved person in the world of Remnant.
Which is impressive, because how she's been presented in the script is so wildly inconsistent that you'd be hard-pressed to even determine a personality for her.
So confident and so loved by everybody.
Okay, I have two problems with that sentence.
It doesn't matter. We know why we're here. Right?
Yeah, I know, but seriously, isn't her whole character arc based off deep-seated abandonment issues? That's the face of confidence. She's fucking insecure.
Thanks anyways. This is hopeless.
Yang has four friends who we only see in episode 2 who never exist again in any sort of capacity. Is that supposed to translate into being popular and loved by everyone in Remnant? Like, she teams up with Blake and all her former friends are like, oh what, she's gay and a furry? Not worth it. I am unconvinced how anyone outside of the main cast even knows who she is.
Even within the world of Remnant, she's like a popular girl.
She's also now known for being disqualified from the tournament.
So you know who I am. You got a name, sweetheart?
Honestly, how could they? She is some random high schooler who has never done anything in her life. She's from a small village that's not even part of a kingdom. And I mean...
Read the news sometime. We totally saved Vale while you were gone.
I heard Vale suffered a Grim attack after you almost managed to stop a train.
The ideas are worth shit if you can't convey them, but you can't even imply them.
She also takes a lot of pride in being a good fighter.
Now, Yang having pride in her ability to fight is something that's been implied throughout the series.
I could have taken him.
So yeah, 1 out of 3.
Don't think we'll go easy on ya. Wouldn't have it any other way.
33%, which is, an F. So yeah.
But Yang would never do that!
Yeah!
You know this is the worst possible character to try to make us feel sympathetic towards, right? Because no matter how hard we try to erase this line from our memory...
I can't take it anymore! Could everyone just chill
seconds before something crazy happens again?
It will always be there. Not to mention everybody in the world watched her go savage, brutal apeshit and almost kill somebody right before breaking his legs, so yeah.
You know, I really will break his legs.
Some men just want to watch the world burn.
The staff here at Beacon are fully aware that you would never lash out the way you did.
They were watching her on hidden camera when, fuck it.
The world saw you attack an innocent student.
In a tournament where the goal is to attack innocent students. Oh, no, fuck it.
As much as he's a stickler for the rules, he knows these students in particular.
No, he goddamn doesn't. He talked to Ruby once.
I think what you did last night is exactly what being a huntress is all about.
He doesn't know shit about these three.
You guys believe me, right, Blake? I want to believe you.
Except, you know that one time when you hit me for no reason? Twice? Like, a week and a half ago? Or that time you flipped out over Nora trying to get in our group hug? Or that time you squeezed that guy's nuts for not knowing your name? Not sure how I know about that. But I need to ask. Is the only reason you're attracted to me because I look exactly like your mother? Because I'm taking the whole borderline psycho murderer vibe with the sexual assaulty implications, but if you're only into me to fulfill some weird Oedipus complex stuff, I'm out of here.
I need you to promise me that you regret having to do what you did. I saw him attack me, so I attacked back. Okay. Thank you.
She, didn't... never mind.
I think I've had enough fighting for 1 year.
You picked the wrong line of work. I have nothing to say about this scene. Except please do nothing to the cook is this season's birdie no.
Carrie.
Hello.
Would you say that you have like at least like one moment per season where you're like, I'm super proud of that thing that I did?
Yeah.
Because mine is please do nothing to the cook.
And honestly, there's worse stuff to get to, so let's just move on.
That was your mom, all right. She didn't say a word, did she?
How did you know that?
She didn't say a word. She said eight.
Yang, we have a lot to talk about.
You mean you talked to her? That was real?
What does that mean?
Originally, we wanted to do a lot more with Raven's story and Yang.
A lot more. A lot more than removing it from the story entirely?
Yeah, Raven's a thing.
Yeah, nothing in this scene makes sense.
Shouldn't let this tournament thing get you down. I say it's time you move on.
Move on? Move on from what? Is he telling Yang not to dwell on the tournament she lost for, like, the week before she goes back to school? The same school that told her to take it seriously?
Those who choose to compete in the combat tournament will be representing all of Vale.
No, not even.
Move on to what?
Raven let some info slip before she took off. If you ever want to track her down.
Now he's telling her to ditch school and follow her mother, who he just got done telling her was super dangerous and didn't want to have to look after her.
She saved you once, but you shouldn't expect that kindness again.
In earlier drafts of the script.
I don't know what to do.
What do you mean?
Do you believe in destiny?
I don't think it's a matter of believing or not. I have it right here. I'm just not really into multiplayer shooters.
When I think of destiny, I don't think of a predetermined fate you can't escape.
Pyrrha, you're not making any sense.
None of it makes any sense. This isn't how things were supposed to happen. There is supposed to be a story about the White Fang fighting for equality or overthrowing the government of Vale or something. And now there's this stupid seasonal maiden bullshit. That's just clearly a ripoff of Avatar. This whole script is bullshit.
Whoa, okay, Jen, calm down. Stick to the script.
No, Miles, you can't write. You won't get away with this any longer. I'm putting a stop to this.
Why is the sound booth door locked from the outside?
But you see, I've already gotten away with it. It's been 3 years and no one stopped me. After manipulating that fool, Bernie Burns, I became the lead writer of the company. Now everyone will bend to my will.
Oops, my fanfiction script got mixed up with the review. This is embarrassing. Where was I? Oh, right. Pyrrha hits Jean and then thanks fuck that no one else was around to see it because the amount of negativity that would have caused would have ended the world on the spot.
Ruby, how you going?
I... like this.
Best vision in Remnant goes to Ruby.
Wait, where does Ruby think this door leads?
to the plot. Shut up, left channel audio version of myself. Now, moving aside from the fact that him being here serves literally no purpose, and that lying about Emerald being away from the Colosseum serves even less of a purpose, let's examine the ways Mercury could have attempted to save the situation. He could have said, "Hi, I'm Mercury's twin brother, who is part of the family who you think Mercury has based on the line from earlier in the episode.
I heard Mercury and his team rush back to Haven to be with his family."
Or, "They put a cast on my leg, or used a healing semblance, or something like that, so I've returned to be questioned about the assault, which is a thing that everyone knew must happen eventually." Or he could have showed her the metal leg and said, "Look what your sister did to me, she's a monster!" There are tons of ways he could have gotten around this, but I suppose being remarkably stupid is one of them. So he just gives up and outs himself as a bad guy for no reason. But Ruby goes, "Oh no."
Penny Polandina from Atlas, Hera Nico from Vegas.
No.
What was she expecting? She knows magnets don't do damage to Penny because they set that up in a joke earlier this volume. A joke that they laughed at.
Magnetism foreshadowing, disguised as a joke.
This joke doesn't make any sense. Go ahead.
Worst case scenario, Pura has a much easier time winning, which is, well, exactly what Ruby wanted her to do.
You be sure to win one for Beacon, okay?
Right?
Uh-huh.
Look at this fight as if the bad guys never existed. These two people are undefeated because for their entire lives they've been compelled by outside forces to lie about their advantages.
We could just keep it our little secret.
Promise me you won't tell anyone about my secret.
And they're competing against each other. One is Riel, who has been forced into an artificial role that she hates with a passion.
It's become impossible to form any sort of meaningful relationship with people.
But doesn't have the self-respect to escape. The other is artificial and is striving to live a normal life.
I want to stay at Beacon.
The girl who hates her situation has the clear advantage, and neither of them know it yet.
This is going to be so much fun.
That's interesting shit. Instead, it's just a robotic Pinocchio going up against a magnetic Achilles because the bad guys think it's going to cause a calamity that'll end the world. Why?
Because over hundreds of thousands of years of evolution alongside the Grimm, these people never figured out that stress was lethal.
No, I mean, why are we doing this?
Hell if I know, my boss is the devil or something.
What's the benefit of making Pura think she was bending her sword? And once again, this is an instance of seeing the manipulated point of view. So only in the most important scene in the whole fucking show do they ignore that rule. Anyway, both of these fights look pretty decent. Now the big issue with this fight is after witnessing this impressive dodging display, Penny thinks it's appropriate to just stand there telegraphing her attack for 9 seconds. Like, is Penny running Windows Vista? Did she need to reboot? If Penny wasn't a fucking idiot, this plan would have failed. When would Emerald have done her thing? Didn't they make a really big deal about Penny having aura? She's a ginger, so we automatically assume she doesn't have a soul. But they included a line of exposition specifically to dispel that notion.
I'm the world's first synthetic person capable of generating an aura.
Now, some would argue that aura doesn't protect against friendly fire, because your sword is not a weapon. It is an extension of yourself, of your body, and your soul. Oh. Then how does it know? Ruby starts crying, and Mercury doesn't kill her. That's the chick. She's the one. Right there. She's the one who knows what's up with your shit. What's the MO for walking away? But before the audience even has time to process how stupid that was, Cinder starts talking.
This is not a tragedy.
Oh, great, thanks for letting us know. We've already established that the news covers shit like this and that it freaks people out. Cinder's plan is almost entirely unnecessary. Wouldn't revealing that the whole thing was orchestrated by some evil mastermind be counterintuitive at this point? I mean, goddamn motherfucking Jean can figure out that Cinder's the bad guy.
Whoever was on the microphone, they're the ones that did this.
Why can't anybody else? Not only are we supposed to believe that Jean is one of the top 12 huntsmen attending Beacon, we're also suddenly supposed to believe that Jean Binoculars Arc is one of the smartest people in the entire planet for being able to tell that some bitch who controls the horizontal and the vertical might be up to no good. Look, if they expect us to care about a world, we have to care about the people in it. And if they're gonna go off depicting everyone in Remnant as worse than Jean, someone who I already wouldn't piss on if he was on fire, then frankly, I'm rooting for the side that wants to destroy it all. What's even more unbelievable, believe it or not, is that in 80 years of this tournament, nobody's ever been killed until right now. Well, I guess nobody was still killed. She's a robot. But nobody's been seriously injured either. I mean, this guy got a Mjolnir to the nads. This chick lost 27% of her aura. In one hit. If she was at 16% before Blake kicked her, her spine would have been broken and nobody would have violated any rules. Weiss got her aura completely drained. What if this geyser went off again? This was a result of Pura just using her raw ability. This could have happened without Cinder's input at all, and yet she's using it to disillusion people to the entire idea of Huntsmen? How? A huntress in training killed a huntress in training because we cheer when they beat the fuck out of each other. Everything Cinder says is really dumb.
This is what happens when you hand over your trust.
No, this is a tournament that happens every 2 years.
Every 2 years?
We all forgot what the word annual meant.
And there's a very clearly defined reason for why it exists.
To test the strengths of the kingdom's warriors.
She tried to drag the leaders of the Huntsman Academies into this by implying that they have some power.
Our academy's headmasters wield more power than most armies.
Which they don't. Even I know this.
The founders of the academies believe that their graduates should be kept separate from kingdom allegiance.
Do people in Remnant not understand the concept of the job boards? Like, at all?
Huntsmen and huntresses are free to choose who they work for through the use of mission boards.
How do I know more about how Remnant works than the fucking people who live there? If they had any power whatsoever, or even knew a random huntsman's phone number or something, the entirety of Ruby would not have happened, because Torchwick would have been arrested way earlier in the, Actually, none of that stuff mattered at all.
Perhaps Osmond felt as though defeating Atlas in the tournament would help people forget his colossal failure to protect Vale when the Grim invaded its streets.
She tries to say Ozpin failed to protect Vale, which, first of all, isn't true, and second,
was retconned, so I don't know what to think anymore. Yeah.
One nation's attempt at a synthetic army?
Attempt at a synthetic army? They already have a synthetic army. You have a thing that's gonna hack it.
Mercilessly torn apart by another star pupil.
Mercilessly? What? Look at her!
What need would Atlas have for a soldier disguised as an innocent little girl? I don't think the Grim can tell the difference.
What even is that line? As opposed to the actual little girl soldier who is standing right there? Once again, we have Ironwood's men standing around like fucking lemons. You can't even give these guys the benefit of the doubt like with the last ones, because they're not even looking at Cinder's tits. Maybe after that mess, Ironwood fired all of his heterosexual guards and these guys are just mesmerized by the phallic bishop on the monitor. Look at this. Look at this shit. 9.6. 9.6! That's a 0.5 tops. After giving them 2 free points for just showing up. Now, after that whole speech, there was one line I was waiting for. And that was for Nora to turn to the group and say,
Guys? Where's the blood?
The what?
The blood! Penny's blood! Where is it? Coco, that black girl you fought made a reference to bleeding.
I'll try not to get blood on it.
Whoa, Nora. Way to play the race card. I thought she was just talking about some hip-hop song I hadn't heard.
God damn it! What you just said was way more racist! Pierre, remember when you were walking through the forest with Jean and he got hit by that branch? That red stuff that came out of his face was blood! Oh, you can't tell me I'm the only one of you who knows what blood is! What is wrong with you people? Look! She has circuit boards and shit instead of bones!
She's a girl, Nora. She can't get boners.
Fuck this! Come on, Ren! We're gonna go watch X-Ray and Vav! I hope you all die! This is how Kimbo must have felt!
Why does that name sound familiar?
Because Penny is a fucking robot! They'll just hit the reboot button and she'll be fine. I mean, they have backup hard drives, right?
Dude, did you just make a backup of yourself?
The universal level of incompetence throughout all of Remnant makes me wonder how they know how to tie their shoes, let alone build robots. So I might not be surprised if they don't have the technology to back up data. But even so, why are people losing their minds over a broken robot? Back in episode 3, you remember, the one I liked? Crow completely invalidates the linchpin of the bad guy's plans by murdering a robot in cold blood in full view of everyone. and it didn't even cause an earth-shattering calamity.
No!
I don't think anyone even noticed. If all it takes to end the world is a broken robot, then why didn't that start the downward spiral? And if it's the intention of the deed, well then, allow me to remind you that Crow was intent on murdering a real-life human.
I mistook this for some sort of sentient garbage.
This scene between Crow and Winter has everything in Cinder's master plan and more, and leads to absolutely no overreaction from anyone. Crow straight up implies that Alice was preparing to take over Vale.
She'll protect you, just like Atlas is gonna protect all of us, huh?
This was his message to the tyrannical dictator that has occupied an unsuspecting kingdom with armed forces.
While armed guards escorted an Atlas specialist into Beacon.
No fucks given.
Cinder's master plan amounted to less than what Crow accomplished in a drunken stupor. Except, for some reason, didn't end the world. Dead robot, murderous intent, an audience, implications of a conflict between Atlas and Vale, misuse of power.
Well, you know what you really are? A bunch of sellouts, just like your boss.
And what, I ask you, is Osben teaching his students?
All of it's right there, except no one cared. What are these fuckers aiming at? People are getting mauled to death on the ground, and you're off shooting dramatically into the middle distance? Do I need to remind everyone that the reason these robots exist is to kill Grimm, and they're terrible at it? You alright there, buddy? What you swinging at?
I don't believe this.
Me neither, Weiss. I don't believe it either. You remember that episode where you were like,
I'll be nicer.
And I was like, this sucks. Those were the good old days. It's nice that the Grimm are so politely letting them have their conversation.
It's really interesting to me that Weiss and Yang are kind of just like standing there talking while all these Grimm are
just running
everywhere.
Why doesn't everyone just pull out their phone so the Grimm will leave them alone? That sword should have a wire on it connecting it to Penny's backpack. We know those wires didn't break because, you remember, right? You know, I wonder if now that Ruby has used a sword and knows the joy of being able to stab stuff, if she'll ever go back to her scythe. This was a really lucky shot. I mean, with wind resistance and all the lockers coming from different places and being called at different times and for them to all hit the Crow like that, well done. Now kill it. Please? Don't just stand there and wait for it to get up. This isn't a tournament match. You can't, like, pretend you have honor by allowing the Grimm to get back up. You can attack them while they're down. They're monsters. What is wrong with this show when no one is capable of attacking an immobilized monster? Do they think it'll be unsportsmanlike? Actually, it would be, because Grimm don't attack huntresses while they're standing stock still in the middle of the battlefield.
Son, I need your scroll.
Wait, she pushed one button. That's not even her scroll. How the fuck do those things work? Port fired a blunderbuss at a student. Yeah, I mean, I know he has tenure, but come on. A shot from that distance could have fucked her up. Here's a point, just one I sometimes consider. Way back in the world of Remnant about Huntsman Academies, yeah, so Ruby and Juniper are both freshman teams. And there's Coffee, but there's like a fuck ton of other students at Beacon. What are they doing? Jerking off in the corner? That's a lot of students at this school whose
sole purpose is to train the next generation of Huntsmen.
I don't think there's enough room in the corner. Why are Default Pose Man and his crew of douches the only ones fighting? There were 123 people competing in this tournament. Why are there only 22 people fighting Grimm? That makes 101 qualified tournament contestants all trying to jerk off in the same corner. There are 3 finalists gone. Now on to one of my favorite lines in the volume, one of the only ones I've considered adequate in quite a while.
No one will fault you if you leave.
This is actually really consistent with Ironwood's character. He doesn't respect huntsmen, or seemingly, individuals at all.
The Atlesian military has always supported the idea of removing men from the dangers of the battlefield.
Probably due to the incompetence of his own guards, and also partly due to Ospin, who at one point he respected enough to serve.
I have served you faithfully for years.
Whatever that means.
You brought this on yourself.
Letting him down by being a fucking pussy about the whole Volume 2 situation, which according to the script of Volume 3 never actually happened, but I digress. He wants robots because robots can be programmed. And he wants robots that look like people because he knows that other kingdoms don't share Atlas's anti-individualist mentality.
And admittedly, a little little less scary.
And they'd be hard-pressed to accept a robot army. But they might be open to accepting a robot guardian. Just so long as Magna Girl doesn't fuck everything up. See, it's the best of both worlds, because you find out later that he's half-robot.
Do you think his goodies are robotic or the genuine thing?
Oh, they're genuine, absolutely.
And which would you prefer?
Which would enforce the idea that his worthless human parts would have ended up getting him killed. So you look back on the scene with hindsight and see that he's actually doing this with good intentions. Because something most likely happened to him to make him wind up like that. And he doesn't want it to happen to anyone else. Now, the line immediately before that...
What should we do?
Yeah, anybody still want to deny my random chance leader assignment theory? How does Torchwick pilot this ship so well if he doesn't know what half the buttons do?
Oh. Now, this one...
Execute Order 66.
I'm wondering who the bad guy's master hacker is. Because they've got some impressive virus skills to be able to hack the CCT and the robot army and the tournament's randomization process. Like, it would be weird if it was one of these four, because Neo was working for Torchwick when the CTT got hacked. I mean, it might be Mercury because he sort of has to be tech-savvy to maintain his legs. But that's mechanical, not really code-based. Emerald has her own role, and it would be weird for her to double up on essential duties. Especially when her power is already redundant since you have Neo.
We get a lot more information in this sequence about how silences work, particularly Emerald's. She can manipulate one person's perception.
What they see, yes.
You know, the difference between her and Neo is that an illusion that Neo will cast, everyone can see.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, with Emerald, it was individual, like, mental hallucinations. With Neo, she can essentially, like, physically manifest.
And Cinder is, well, how do I put this politely? Retarded? That doesn't explain why these robots have red LEDs for when they turn evil, but I'd still be interested in seeing the character who programmed these world-ending viruses. But having a bad guy that smart might be a little OP because Blake is so dumb she has a worse grasp on the concept of cover than Pura does. What, are they trying to win a poorest decision-making award?
I'm going to sit here with my big red bullseye-shaped head above the cover.
Yeah, well, I'm gonna duck behind nothing.
Yeah, well... I'm going to have a romantic interest in Jean Arc.
Adam and Yang.
Shit. Well, I'm going to fight the Fall Maiden with no hope of winning.
All right, I give up.
Are you guys having a poor decision-making contest? Instead of calling Glendane Crow, like Ozpin asked me to, I called Weiss, then broke my phone.
I trusted Jean.
Mr. Arc, if you'd like to help, you can stand guard here.
Twice.
Back to the point, why are these robots surrounding them? Like, instead of just shooting them?
Wipe them out. All of them.
If the orders were to wipe them out, all of them, then why are they taking prisoners?
Why would they be programmed like that? I mean, they don't show the same courtesy to Ironwood. Ruby is a badass. I mean, she just is. This is why she's the main character. From this point on, like the last quarter of the volume, stuff actually starts happening like any normal story. Order 66, so Ironwood crashes, so Ruby goes to take back his ship for him, but since she's as dense as a neutron star, Torchwick feels the impact, so he and Neo fight her on the hull of the ship. I mean, really, this is the equivalent of a bird shitting on your car. In order for her to rock the bridge like this, Ironwood's flagship must weigh like 10% of what a standard 747 airliner weighs, or Ruby would have to weigh, you know, over a ton. Take your pick. So I guess what I actually mean to say is that by this point in the series, we've reached critical problem. Why are people panicking? Bad writing? Why are there only 20-something students out of an entire tournament roster and Huntsman Academy fighting Grimm?
The Huntsman Academies. These institutions' sole purpose is to train the next generation of Huntsmen.
Bad writing. Why are there only 2 graduated Huntsmen in the entire Kingdom of Vale? Bad writing. Why is Mercury filming in landscape? Oh, wait, seriously? He's not filming vertical video? That's still bad writing. No, really, it's bad writing.
Remember, everybody, even Mercury Black, a terrible, moralist person, knows always film videos landscape.
If people in Remnant are so prone to panic and stress, don't you think broadcasting vertical video would frustrate enough people to increase the Grim Horde tenfold? But the Kraken gets unleashed anyway. It's a Wyvern. Shut up! Why does this thing birth fully matured Grimm?
You know, we've established the longer a Grimm exists, the more ferocious and feral and
bigger and spinier kind of stuff.
Younger Grimm tend to be more reckless, older Grimm, who have managed to survive their battles, have the tendency to learn from their experience.
Bad writing. Why are 17 students struggling to take down two of the things that a flying corgi managed to dismantle? Oh wait, no, they actually did explain this one.
It's fortunate those paladins were still in the prototype stage.
Yeah! Then Coco says,
Hey, Velvet! You remember that thing we built up for the whole last semester?
No. I remember the thing we forgot to build up for the whole last semester. And then they were like, Hey, we've been building this thing up for the whole semester. Is that the thing you're talking about?
Shut up, Velvet. We're both written by the same asshole. There's no reason for you to give me lip like that.
But how is she even able to hurt these mechs if the people she's copying couldn't? If she was actually stronger than 16 students working together, how in the brick shits did her mission take longer than expected?
Your mission was supposed to end a week ago. What happened?
I keep forgetting Volume 2 didn't happen. So, yeah, bad writing. And bad animation. And bad judgment. And bad everything, really. The biggest challenge I had writing this review was resisting the urge to take my own life. But the second biggest challenge was trying to place whether this fight or the first one in the volume was worse. I think that that one is made much worse, and that this one is conceived much worse. They're animated by the same person, who is also the guy that added the excessively long reaction cutaways to the fight from episode 4. So Shane's right-hand man was responsible for all the worst animation in the volume.
For a lot of those trailer shots you're seeing right now, we went and got the original files, popped the animation on Velvet.
Despite that, she's arbitrarily overpowered. Like, what's the reasoning behind this fight? Is having Blake's weapon to trip up this mech really the deciding factor in a 17 versus 2 battle? This bitch has a weapon with a string on it. Why couldn't she have Star Wars'd these mechs? You know, I thought that Monty had a good idea for what Velvet's weapon was, and that it was actually cool enough to deserve the hype that they were pretending to give it.
Come on, you spent all semester building that up.
And the only reason they ended up going with this copy-pasted garbage was that Monty never told anybody what it was supposed to be. But no, apparently they knew the whole time that Velvet's box was just full of recycled animation.
For a long time we've known what we wanted Velvet to be.
And yet, they're actually pleased with themselves.
Oh, what? That's amazing.
What? She even stole my move.
I mean, even on principle, your show is named after a team, and instead of showing any themes that support the notion that teamwork is good, you show this one character dominating a foe that 17 students working together couldn't lay a hand on, and her teammates don't even let her participate. And even if that doesn't matter to you, there's always the technical failings. For instance, the last time she was seen with her box, she was holding it in one hand, like it itself was the weapon. We should realize now that that would make it impossible to use. But I keep referencing a fight that wasn't canon! God! So her semblance is just rogue. Great. She's an OP rogue. And of course everyone stands stock still and waits for their turn to fight. Nobody even gives her a heads up when this third paladin shows up. And then Weiss ends up killing the poor guy piloting this thing. Remember?
I'm glad we got cockpit closing animation in there, because I rigged that in.
The paladin mechs were designed for human pilots.
There are still many situations that undoubtedly require a human touch.
That's why they exist. That's, you know,
these mechanized battleships will be seen defending the borders of our kingdom within the year.
Or was that supposed to be retconned too? Why is Weiss able to summon? Bad writing. She gets a scene that's like,
Now think to your fallen foes.
Like, she wasn't trying hard enough, and now she is? She didn't earn that. She doesn't have any new fallen foes to think to. This isn't how character development works. But on the bright side, nothing else in this volume is that bad. Or even close to that bad. The next half an hour... Oh, for fuck's sake. Anyway, it's actually pretty good. Moving on from one of the worst fights in the series to one of the best. Top three, easily. A little for choreography, which is good for Volume 3, but mostly for theming, which is one of those scenes that makes me wonder if Miles and Carrie have some sort of weird curse on them where writing poorly is the only way to generate the power it takes to write the occasional good scene. Here, Ruby, who has abandoned her team and has never been shown to work well with them despite being a leader.
I have a plan. Help me!
gets absolutely stomped by Torchwick and Neo, who are exhibiting far better teamwork than anyone else in the show up to this point ever has.
And a little help from her, not friends.
Except maybe this move, but fuck you if I have to acknowledge that anything in that first fight is cool. But it makes all the poor teamwork in the rest of the series come to a head, adding weight to all of the times they have abandoned one another.
12 hours.
Nearly 2 days.
Or stand there watching Yang get hit. Or accidentally make Torchwick target one of their own teammates. And most of the time, teamwork amongst the members of Ruby boils down to, okay, thanks, bye.
I like how it reinforces the concept of a team of four.
Mm-hmm. Ditto.
So having Ruby get taken out by this block and counter and then a wombo combo enforces the power of teamwork, except it's from the bad guy's point of view. Now, there's a lot that I don't know that some might consider important information. For instance, what are the bad guy's plans? And how much does Torchwick know about them? But he's orchestrating the White Fang and Grimm teaming up to take out the Huntsman, and he can't afford to lose.
It's not what I have to gain, it's that I can't afford to lose!
He calls Ruby the Hero of Vale, mockingly, as if she doesn't know what she's standing in the way of.
You are just determined to be the Hero of Vale, aren't you?
Which fits with her most consistent character trait.
That's very ambitious for a child.
Naivety.
The people that hired me are going to change the world.
Whether he's talking about the White Fang or Salem, I personally don't think matters much at this point. What is important is the character dynamic of someone who,
I may be a gambling man,
for lack of a better word, knows when to hold 'em, knows when to fold 'em, knows when to walk away and when to run, and someone who is unflappably idealistic on the opposite side of a conflict the audience has no way of understanding. The protagonist being defined by childish optimism, and the antagonist being defined by jaded calculation, and evil getting the upper hand both physically and ideologically, only for Ruby to turn the tables with a cheap underhanded trick that's actually pretty funny.
You've been Mary Poppins.
Mary Poppins own.
How on earth could Ruby Rose beat Neo and Torchwick? The answer was with a funny gag.
Then calling upon the powers of her optimism with the heroic cliche of saying something in itself cliched.
I don't care what you say, I will stop you. Then I'm dead!
Before pulling a victory out of her ass only to be met with a blast to the face and a pummeling. Again, Ruby meeting a dirty trick with another dirty trick, kicking Torchwick in the knee. Every word Torchwick says during this beatdown is solid gold.
You got spirit, Red, but this is the real world!
Unfortunately, the real world isn't the same as a fairy tale.
You wanna be a hero? Then play the part and die like every other huntsman in history!
Well, you can't spend your entire life on the battlefield, even if you may want to.
The real world is cold! The real world doesn't care about spirit!
His tirade about how cold and uncaring the world is culminates with his sudden and random out-of-nowhere death that proves beyond a shadow of a doubt that the real world is cold and uncaring. It doesn't even care about who earned the victory the hard way. I love this scene so much that I don't even care that Ruby, who is supposed to be awful without her scythe...
She sucks without her weapon. No. Yeah. It's a crutch.
Ruby ain't all that when she doesn't have her weapon.
Yeah, that was one of the very first things, right?
Kicked two giant Grimm to death without it. This confrontation ended in such a way that Ruby could have learned that Torchwick was right after all, because his death was the result of a cold, uncaring world.
Somewhere in the darkness, the gambler, he broke even. But in his final words, I found an ace that I could keep.
Or that his death was a result of the world being a warm and caring place that falls in line with Ruby's optimistic ideology, which makes it a massively important growth moment for Ruby whether she decides to learn anything or not.
What is this place?
It's a type of vault.
What would this school need to...
And there goes my optimistic ideology. It's a vault. They keep things safe, not hidden. What, do you go to a bank and tell them to hide your money? You fucking animals. Way to take me out of my good mood. The Adam and Blake scene is another really good one.
We were destined to light the fires of revolution.
So the title of this episode is Heroes and Monsters, a callback to the last episode of Volume 1, Black and White, where we learned the origins of the White Fang. Black and White, Heroes and Monsters, Blake is black, Weiss is white, Faunus are heroes, Mankind are the monsters, you get it? It's like a thing. This is yet another case of me having no idea how much Adam knows about Cinder's plan, or even if he thinks he knows the same thing Torchwick does. But Adam's mental breakdown is really core here.
I'm not running.
You get it? Because it's that thing from last volume?
I ran.
That thing she never exhibited signs of?
You will.
Wait, what? He knows she's gonna run away.
They have no idea how creepy this guy is.
Instead of Torchwick's jadedness versus Ruby's optimism, we have Adam's wrathful idealism clashing with Blake's, inability to be written well, I guess. Because the White Fang, at least from an ideological standpoint, is in the right.
Despite being promised equality, the Faunus were subjected to discrimination and hate.
Because their accord with the humans after the Faunus War was not honored.
Despite being promised equality?
But unfortunately, they are represented by someone like Adam.
And he also represents the Faunus, for better or worse, and he's actually that inhuman.
Yeah.
So you need someone smart to spell it out for you. But you still won't get it. Sorry, that was what we in the industry like to call salt. But Adam is a madman. But he knows what her powers are. So this was probably just cathartic, like ripping up pictures of an ex, except in 3D.
Mr. R, if you'd like to help, you can stand guard here.
Now Jean's incompetence finally kicks off the thrilling conclusion.
Pura!
Damn it, Jean, don't watch Pura scream. If you wanted to help, you should be standing guard. Ugh, if only she was wearing armor right there. Like, in that one specific spot, right there. Isn't this thing unnecessarily overdesigned? Like, it tilts up, and then there are glowy tubes? Shouldn't it be stationary? Like, shouldn't there be a shorter length of tube directly across the chambers? Why do they need a view window? Wouldn't they be concerned that the force of someone struggling against the aura transfer might break the glass? Oh, who cares? She just lets them go. Fuck it. Much like the Crow in Winter Fight making the students we've seen up to this point look ineffective and weak, we get to see the top-level fighters in another awesome fight. Which does sort of make me wonder why Cinder moved so slowly when she fought Pura. Like, did she not want to hurt her feelings before killing her? Gosh, if only she was wearing armor right there, like in that one specific spot right above her cleavage. Hashtag feminism. Sadly, the better of the two fights in this final episode only lasts for 30 seconds. I mean, they could have cut this shipping scene to make room for more action. Not that kind of action. Oh, really? The most popular ships are cannon? Woohoo! Well done. You have such artistic integrity.
I have a plan. You always do.
Do you care to share that plan with your teammate? No? Okay. I take it back. You two dumbasses were made for each other. And so are these two dumbasses. Pura's arc is one of the best in the show. I mispronounced only. Silly me. Where was I? Oh, right. Pura's arc was the only one in the show, and it was coincidentally pretty good, mostly because she's dead, so they can't pussy out of it like they did with Weiss. So let's get examining this magnificent suicide. The first thing you might notice about Pura is how her name sort of sounds like the word Pyrrhic.
I remember one person, I think in Volume 1, pointed out, hey, has anybody ever heard of Pyrrhic Victory?
Yeah.
Unless you weren't that one person. Then I guess the first thing you might notice about Pura is how she swooned over Jean. Boy, her relationship with Jean sure was a roller coaster of emotions. In the first volume, it wasn't canon.
Pura is incredibly nice. Our belief is that Pura acts this way towards everybody.
But then it was. But the only reason there was any tension in it was because of an ad-lib during casting that created a love triangle that wasn't a love triangle.
And yep. The scene that we improvised was, it was lunch, she was trying to eat. Jean was just bugging her. That was the scene. I decided to go, so tell me about this Weiss girl. And in that improv session, we were like, that's what okay, we so Jean needs to be infatuated with Weiss.
That's when we came up with the snow angel line and the whole infatuation with Weiss.
But it finally came to a head in the scene that was super melodramatic.
When you're placed on a pedestal like that for so long, you become separated from the people that put you there in the first place.
But in hindsight, much less stupid than I had initially thought, because they actually delivered on what I didn't think they had the balls for.
Thanks to you, I've made friendships that will last a lifetime.
Earlier in this video, I referred to Pura's arc as Sophoclean. I mean, I might have. This video is long. I don't remember. Pura's life is more or less defined by the things that Sophocles loved banging on about. No, not her own mother. That's Yang. But the commentary did seem to confuse Yang with Pura, so maybe the connection is a little more intentional than we thought it was. But I'm actually talking about honesty, self-harm, fate, love, and death. Because Pura was placed on a pedestal because she had an unfair advantage over everyone else in the form of her magnet powers.
I've been blessed with incredible talents and opportunities.
An advantage that she kept secret from everyone else.
Or perhaps we could just keep it our little secret.
So she only has herself to blame for being unapproachable.
You become separated from the people that put you there in the first place.
She thought being with Jean was what she needed. Pure thought that working towards her destiny would free her from the false limelight that she didn't earn. But again, she gets handed a power on a silver plate. But since it's the only thing she knows, she accepts it.
Which is why we would like to—
I'll do it.
She can't stop herself from being unhappy.
I don't know what to do.
It's time to stop!
Either because she was told that was the only way to be when she was younger.
When I think of destiny, I don't think of a predetermined fate you can't escape, but rather some sort of final goal.
Or that it's just her fate. It works in the context that Pura was once told the wrong definition of destiny and believed it. Kissing Jean and then choosing to fight Cinder with no reasonable hope of winning was her only hope of victory over her fate. Consider the possible outcomes. She kills Cinder and gets the Maiden's power, thus fulfilling her destiny. Absorbing Amber's soul fundamentally changes her, so she escapes her self-loathing.
And there's no telling if you will be the same person if it does.
Or it could leave her the same, so she could go back to Jean, gaining a little happiness. She could get rescued.
Find Glinda, Ironwood, Crow. Bring them here right away.
Meaning that she lost and escaped the stigma of being the invincible girl.
The invincible girl.
Thus escaping her fate and self-loathing. Or she dies, escaping her fate and self-loathing. Pura didn't feel like she had control over her life.
I've always felt as though I was destined to become a huntress, and it's become increasingly clear to me that my feelings were right.
And this was the only way of proving it, one way or the other. I mean, intentional or not, she's dead. They can't go back on this. Pura's arc was tragic and beautiful and riddled with melodrama. And to tie it up in an even nicer little bow, Cinder fucking evaporates. Meaning the power that haunted her, that she pursued and died for, wasn't really worth shit in the grand scheme of things. And she died before getting to know that. But hey, some people just can't win. Oh god, there's gonna be a volume 4. Oh, fuck. There's even more to this episode, isn't there?
Wait! Yang! Is she alright?
She's gonna be alright.
I can't believe they missed a perfect opportunity for a pun. All he had to say was no, and we would have gotten it.
And Ozpin's still missing.
Pura, is she...
She's gone.
Wait, Ozpin is missing, but Pura is gone? How do you know? Cinder disintegrates her enemies. So why do you think Ozpin is missing? That's awful foreshadowing. Foreshadowing done right was like the RTX Australia panel.
I don't know what my arm's doing right now, but it's doing something.
Yeah, you do. Don't lie to these people. See, you could tell Yang was about to lose her dominant arm because she spent the entire Q&A practicing masturbating with her left.
That neon cat had a pretty sweet outfit. I'll take it off her, and then she'll have no clothes.
I'm so glad you're okay.
But I'm not.
This penultimate scene had its mood entirely tarnished by hopefully unintentionally hilarious dialogue.
Weiss's father came for her.
What? What do you mean?
Like, why does Ruby react like that? Was she expecting Weiss to be at her home? In Patch? She hears that Weiss is with her family in Atlas, just like how Ruby and Yang are with their family in their home, and she isn't relieved? It's like the best case scenario. Or this.
No one outside of Vale knows what happened here. Before the tower fell, the last thing people saw was Atlas attacking innocent people and Grimm destroying the city.
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. I award you no points, and may God have mercy on your soul.
Isn't that exactly what happened? And now, suddenly, you blew your emotional moment because I'm laughing.
Sometimes bad things just happen, Ruby.
Miles has been promoted to the head writer of animation at Arushiti's.
And then off walks a team comprised of characters who we don't actually hate all that much yet into the horizon.
They did it. They pruned the shitty cast.
Now watch them fuck it up.
They're aging up a little bit. We don't get to specifics too much, but there is a bit of a time jump.
Wait, is he trying to rationalize not writing character development?
It's like, they're the same characters. They are. And obviously they've evolved.
Oh god, he is. He really is. Why is he allowed to do this? Actually, they're on the island of Patch right now, so they're probably just walking to the docks or maybe an airport where they're going to take a ship or something to Mistral. Why is Team Orange...
Ranger.
The group of four people that appears to be our team for Volume 4. Is that Team Journey or Team Orange? What are we doing here?
It's neither.
Neither.
Ranger isn't a color. Jean is yellow, Ruby is red, you fucks. Orange. Anyway, this... Team Orange is going to Mistral. What are they expecting to find? How did they know Cinder wasn't the mastermind of the plan? Why do the adults, who apparently know what's going on, have to trick children into doing their bidding?
Our enemy's trail leads all the way to Haven.
So that's Ruby Season 1, all wrapped up. The fact that they finished so strong is the main reason that I can't say Volume 3 is the worst volume. Is it better than Volume 1? But what did it all amount to? They claim to be learning to write as they wrote.
We've been learning to write the show as we write the show.
But that's not acceptable. It's been 3 years and you still haven't figured this out? The introduction phase includes introducing the central conflict. The rising action has to build off of what was introduced in the first act, and the climax has to pay off what was built up to by the rising action. The denouement has to be anything other than a deus ex machina. Anything other than a deus ex machina is okay. Literally anything. Oh, fuck it. So the climax happens somewhere between here and here, depending on how smart you are. So let's try to reverse engineer a plot out of this. The Grim Invasion was a distraction to allow Cinder to access the underground vault. The rising action starts here in episode 9, and that would mean the introduction... Oh, there wasn't one. Because if you know anything about sociology or evolution, this type of reaction would never have happened.
For as long as humanity can recall walking the surface of Remnant, so do they remember this wicked force. These beings serve as the greatest foe to mankind. Some key facts have been observed in the wild. The creatures of Grimm are lured towards negative emotion.
Unless they're trying to pull some cutting commentary on creationist mentality. The whole series seems to be predicated on 5.5 hours of filler. I mean, the notion that no one ever figured out that Grimm were attracted to negativity.
Their attraction to negativity. Sadness. Envy. Loneliness. Hatred.
Fear and stress and sadness shouldn't be part of this culture at all. And yet, the entirety of Volumes 1 and 2 are about racism, and Volume 3 is about how some rando breaking a bone will cause more civil unrest than a fucking race war.
Oop! We'll break his legs!
Some men just want to...
Oh, wait, I already did that joke. So that's out. Let's start with an introduction and see if we can work our way forward to a plot. The first three episodes work well enough. We get a bad guy, some good guys, a drunk, a school, and the central conflict is this guy wants dust. Okay, what's the rising action? I mean, I guess this scene was supposed to handle the entire rising action from Volume 1? Oh, he got dust. Oh, okay.
We're gonna need more men.
Ah, right. Then at the end of the volume, he has more men, because I guess we didn't need to see that, and he needs even more dust. Okay, why? What's he doing with it? I guess it doesn't matter because he doesn't have it yet. Oh, so now he suddenly has more dust.
Sorry if I've been a little busy stealing every speck of dust in the kingdom.
Oh, look, he's getting more men. Great. Okay, so now he has everything he wants and we're still waiting on that introduction, guys. And then in episode 11, we finally get our introduction of what was going on in the first two volumes.
He's leading Grimm to the city!
Well done. This would count as a climax, I guess. And next are Deus- I meant Denouement. It's a magically overpowered valley girl. And the second failed attempt at a narrative arc is predicated on that not having happened.
His colossal failure to protect Vale when the Grimm invaded its streets.
Volume 2 actually originally had a completely different ending, and we tweaked it, and I like the way it turned out. The other one would have been just too much to try and handle.
On top of contradicting everything we've been told about the lore. But now we have our new team, which is a bunch of new dynamics to explore. I say with unyielding dismay at the realization of how the former season's character dynamics were treated.
The fans bought into the characters, I should say.
Yeah.
Like, people love these characters.
Yeah. The problem is that none of these people did anything. That's like the number one rule of storytelling. The main characters do stuff. No, it's not even the number one rule. It's like it's understood before you even decide to write anything. What did the main characters in Ruby do? Nothing. The answer is nothing. Everything was done off-screen by Cinder or Torchwick. And none of it mattered. If the four main characters were not in the story at all, absolutely nothing would be different. Because of them, Torchwick failed to steal the dust in Volume 1, but he stole it off-screen anyway. Because of them, the Train of Doom plan got interrupted, but that got retconned into a completely different scene the next time it was referenced. Yang got framed by the bad guys, but the way they framed Pyrrho was infinitely more effective. As Pablo Picasso and the Dalai Lama have both said, you have to learn the rules before you break them. Why are you shitting on these two great men? What did they do to offend you so deeply?